We are live on the Alex Jones Show on this Thursday, October the 13th edition. I'll be your host for the next 2 hours. I'm Paul Joseph Watson. In the third hour, we've got Kim.com. Of course, the mega upload founder, constantly harassed, constantly pursued by the US government. He came out with a very interesting tweet a few days ago suggesting that he had information on Hillary Clinton that has yet to be seen. So I'm sure we'll be asking him about that in the third hour. Second hour, Stefan Molyneux joins me for an in-depth interview on the latest WikiLeaks, the Podesta email dump, and of course the latest devastating scandals about Donald Trump. We have a situation with the mainstream media now. They're not talking about Bill Clinton taking a $1 million birthday check from Qatar. That just came out as of 2 hours ago. A country that imprisons gay people. A country in which it's still legal for a husband to beat and rape his wife. But Hillary Clinton is the big feminist, the big women's rights champion. Bill Clinton taking a $1 million birthday check from Qatar so they could have pay-for-play access in Haiti after that devastating earthquake. Absolute bombshell revelation on top of all the others. Obama, the Obama White House funding and supporting ISIS, which also came out in the Podesta WikiLeaks emails. Of course, we had the Clinton campaign deleting emails despite knowing it was illegal. That came out a couple of days ago, but the New York Times is not interested in talking about any of that. They're interested in talking about a woman who claims with no evidence that Donald Trump touched her on a plane in the 80s. That's the big New York Times bombshell that they've got. Again, Donald Trump making a comment in Trump Tower saying, oh, I'm going to be dating her in 10 years as some girls go up an escalator. That's the massive bombshell. 20, 30-year-old alleged incidents with no evidence, comments, remarks from 1992. Yeah, in the Podesta emails, we have bombshell after bombshell after revelation, and none of them give a damn. They're not interested in telling you about it. And why not? Well, we know why. Because the emails also reveal that the media, the vast majority of it, is not only pro-Hillary, doesn't just have a pro-Hillary bias, it literally is the Hillary Clinton campaign. I mean, how many examples do we need to see by this point? Journalists giving Hillary questions in advance of town hall debates. Univision in concert, again, shaping the narrative before it happens. We've got Louise Mensch, these never-Trumpers, actually writing Hillary campaign ads for her campaign and being praised for it while pretending to be conservatives. Absolute bombshell revelations. We're going to go through the list later on. Name by name of these Clinton friendlies, these Clinton surrogates that have completely abandoned any pretense of neutrality, of actual journalistic integrity, to become complete prostitutes for Hillary Clinton. And then they have the nerve to attack me, to attack InfoWars, over this whole Bill Clinton rape protest, which we're going to get into further as well, because the Clinton campaign is not very happy about it, because it's actually overturning the narrative on these Trump tapes. Of course, we were told before the weekend that Trump's campaign was in total chaos. It was about to collapse. GOP establishment members were told privately that Trump was about to stand down. That was a complete hoax. It failed completely. And now we have the evidence of that. Rasmussen poll. After the debate, which Trump obviously won, CNN and the rest of them came out with their biased polls that said that Hillary creamed him once again. Well, this is the response from Americans. The latest Rasmussen Reports White House Watch national telephone and online survey shows Trump with a 43% support amongst likely US voters to Clinton's 41%. Now, yesterday's poll showed Clinton with a 4-point lead over Trump. Today, Trump is ahead. And bearing in mind Rasmussen, we've seen the other polls. Rasmussen is the only poll. We are back. It's the Alex Jones Show live with breaking news as it happens on the WikiLeaks releases at InfoWars.com. Now, before the break, we were just getting into this, of course. Last week, Days before that shocking Trump tape was released, GOP insiders were told, and this is from insiders within the Trump campaign, most of this hasn't even come out yet. I mean, I'm so bombarded with WikiLeaks information, I haven't even had a chance to write this article. But insiders were told, GOP establishment insiders were told, that Trump was going to drop out, that he was going to stand down, that Mike Pence was going to take his place, that they had to get out of endorsing Trump before he stood down in order to not go down with the sinking ship. That's what they were told days before this Trump tape was released last week. You had Jerry Falwell saying that he was told of a plan by GOP insiders, Paul Ryan, Mitt Romney, Jeb Bush, that crowd, 6 weeks before, that they were going to launch this attack against Trump, that it would force him to stand down. Of course, it was a complete and total hoax. How many scandals about Donald Trump do we need to hear? And the narrative is, oh, this is it for Trump. It's all over for him. No, it hasn't been over for him in any one of those instances. So why should we believe it now? So you had McCain come out. You had Paul Ryan come out, distance themselves from Trump. Again, the polls came out and showed that the vast majority of people were sick of the GOP establishment. They didn't want them to back away from Trump. It was another media hoax. Complete hoax. Now the polls come out. Rasmussen, despite the fact CNN saying that Trump lost the debate and now he's finished after the tape, after a woman said that Trump touched her on a plane in the 80s with no evidence whatsoever. Again, they said Trump was finished. His campaign was sunk. Now he's got to step down, right? Well, wrong. They were wrong again. What a surprise. Rasmussen, Trump is ahead. 43% to 41%. Now, bearing in mind, this is not a poll. This is not like NBC's poll, which is literally run by a Clinton Foundation lackey who's been paid by them, which oversamples Democrats 10, 20, 30% each time, like Monmouth polls, like all these other rigged polls, the post-debate polls. Rasmussen is reasonably fair in that it samples, on average, an equal number of Republicans and Democrats, and this is what they're saying. In the latest national telephone and online survey, which was taken after the shocking, damning Trump tape, after the debate, we're talking October 10th to October 12th, the first part of this week, it shows likely U.S. voters support Trump 43% to Clinton's 41%, overturning a 4% lead that Clinton had over Trump just a day previously, overturning a lead of 7 points that she had on Monday. So we've seen an amazing resurgence by Trump just this week alone, due in no small part to the Bill Clinton rape protests, which the Clinton campaign are now panicking about. I'm going to have more on that later. But Rasmussen reports that its White House Watch survey daily Monday through Friday, based on a three-day rolling average of 1,500 likely U.S. voters, again, three times the sample size that the likes of CNN use. Again, it was the first following the release of an 11-year-old video showing Trump discussing women in graphic sexual detail, but did not include any polling results taken after the debate. So they're talking about the previous poll. All three nights of the latest survey follow Sunday's debate. So this is after the debate. This is after the tape. Again, before that, 7 points ahead for Clinton. After that, Trump is now 2 points ahead. 84% now say they are certain how they will vote in this year's presidential election. And among these voters, Trump posts a 49% to 46% lead over Clinton. So again, that goes to the heart of there's more enthusiasm behind Trump supporters. They're more likely to get out there on the day and vote, whereas lukewarm Hillary Clinton supporters aren't. And you saw the same thing before Brexit. The people who really wanted Brexit, they had more enthusiasm. They could be bothered to get off their backsides and actually go and vote and win it, and then not whine about losing afterwards and demanding a recount or demanding a second referendum. So there's far more enthusiasm behind Trump. Among voters who say they could still change their minds between now and Election Day, it's Clinton 40%, Trump 37%. So again, 3% more Clinton supporters than Trump supporters say that they could still change their minds. So again, more votes up for grabs for Trump. Johnson supporters, 19%, say they could still change their minds, and Stein, 4%. So again, those votes remain up for grabs. Now listen to this. Most Republican voters still think top GOP leaders are hurting the party with their continuing criticism of Trump, and are only slightly more convinced that those leaders want Trump to be president. So this GOP insider establishment attack has not only not worked, again, it's proven to be unpopular with actual Republican voters. So again, this hoax that everybody's abandoning the ship, everybody's running into the arms of Paul Ryan, complete BS, disproven once again as another media hoax. Trump has 75% support among Republicans, nearly identical to Clinton's 76% backing among Democrats. He has 15% of the Democratic vote, whereas she picks up 13% GOP support. So again, more of the Republicans are behind Trump than Democrats are behind Hillary. Trump holds a double-digit advantage among voters not affiliated with either major political party. So the hoax failed. The GOP insiders who tried to convince everyone that Trump was going to stand down, that he was going to stand aside for Mike Pence, and that they should get out before the ship sinks, you know, to preserve their amazing reputations or whatever, complete hoax. Proven wrong once again. Now, we have more evidence of that being a complete failure. CBS News reports, headline, nearly 100,000 Pennsylvania voters switched from Democrat to Republican. Nearly 100,000 Pennsylvania Democrats have switched to Republican since the beginning of the year. Complete exodus from the Democratic Party in Pennsylvania. What's more, the Pennsylvania Republican Party says more than 240,000 new voters have joined the party since last November. So a huge surge, again, on the back of Donald Trump's campaign, you know, which is supposedly so unpopular with Republicans that they're just abandoning him in droves. Complete hoax. Absolute hoax proven wrong once again. The party says the new numbers come from the Pennsylvania Department of State, which shows that 97,600 Democrats have actually switched to Republican. Numbers show 38,000 Republicans have switched to Democrats. So again, they're abandoning the Democratic Party in droves. If it's an unpopularity war between Clinton and Trump, then again, Clinton's not doing too well out of it. But again, what's the mainstream media talking about? Are they talking about the $1 million birthday check from Qatar handed to Bill Clinton in return for pay-for-play favors in Haiti? No, they're not talking about that. They're not talking about bombshell emails showing that the Obama administration knew they were arming, supporting ISIS when they went into Libya to topple Gaddafi. They're not talking about the Clinton campaign deleting emails knowing it was illegal. Again, absolute bombshell revelations. Nobody could even keep up with them at this point. The Podesta emails are now at round six. Round six released today. They're not only dumping them once a day, they're dumping them multiple times daily. But what's the mainstream media talking about? They're talking about Donald Trump accused by a woman with no evidence that he touched her on a plane in the 80s. That's their big story. Complete ignorance of all these actual bombshells that directly impact the lives of Americans right now, the future of the country. No, that's not important enough to report on. But what is important, what's their top story? Donald Trump made a comment about some girls on an escalator in 1992 saying, in 10 years, I might date you. How in any way does that impact actual working Americans today or the future of the country? It doesn't. But that's what they're going with, because they think that by turning Donald Trump into Bill Cosby, when in actual fact it's Bill Clinton who is Bill Cosby, that they can sink Donald Trump. This Rasmussen poll suggests that it's not working. Now we got a headline out of Zero Hedge. This is war. Trump drafting lawsuit against New York Times for story he groped and kissed woman. And this is how it reads, with the Podesta email leaks now a daily feature providing further insights into the inner workings of the Clinton campaign, and with the shock over the Trump tapes fading, a new distraction had to emerge to keep the public distracted. And sure enough, it happened last night when several women came forward to allege that they had been groped or forcibly kissed by Donald Trump as far back as 36 years ago. Now, again, this is Jessica Leeds, somebody who's donated to the Democratic Party, somebody who's a Democratic operative. In fact, there's some information on Twitter which suggests, although it's not proven yet, that she could actually share a phone number with the Clinton Foundation itself. Obviously, this is a setup, but it looks like it could be yet another complete hoax. So you've got this woman who is essentially saying, you know, this famous billionaire sexually assaulted me and is running for president. Oh, but I better keep it a secret for 35 years until it fits the media narrative. That's what she's basically claiming, this so-called incident at the time. She didn't report it to airline staff. She didn't report it to the police. She sat on it for 35 years. And just by coincidence, started talking about it to the New York Times, which again is completely in bed with Hillary Clinton, as exposed by the WikiLeaks emails, less than 4 weeks before the vote. Isn't that an amazing coincidence? And we'll get more into that and the latest WikiLeaks revelations after the break. This is The Alex Jones Show Live, breaking news at Infowars.com. Stay with us. We're back live on The Alex Jones Show. Stefan Molyneux is coming up in the next hour to talk about these latest WikiLeaks bombshells. We're now on to release number 6 from the Podesta emails. The cucked surrogate media has completely failed in its task once again to even adequately cover them. I mean, I'm amazed day to day. You know, I'm somebody who was making videos, jokey videos, ranting about fat feminists a year ago. And here I am, having to do the media's job for it. I mean, you know, Mike Cernovich, Stefan Molyneux, myself, a smattering of actual journalists. I mean, I don't even refer to myself as a journalist, but at this point, I'm having to do their job for them on a daily basis, every single day, that I might as well take their mantle, because they've completely failed. You know, I put out a tweet a few hours ago, which went like this: desperation with which the establishment is lashing out at Trump doesn't match with the poll numbers, something is up. And that's a question that a lot of people are asking. If Trump is so far behind in the polls, with their rigged polls as they claim on a daily basis, why does the establishment seem to be in uber panic mode with all these hoax scandals coming out against Trump? Why do they seem to be so desperate? Do their internal polls suggest something very different? Well, Rasmussen came out today and confirmed that again. Trump is ahead 43% to 41% after the debates, after the so-called bombshell that would end his campaign, the Trump tape that was released last Friday. Over the last 2 days, voters support him over Hillary Clinton. That's why they're panicking, because their campaign, their plot to have GOP insiders abandon Trump, then convince other Republicans that had endorsed Trump to abandon him, fell flat on its face. It just didn't work. That's why they seem to be in a greater and greater panic. And it's been caused in no small part by the Bill Clinton rape protests. We're going to get onto that later, because, again, some new revelations there. But this is what the media isn't talking about. This is out the Daily Caller. WikiLeaks: Qatar gave Clinton Foundation $1 million check for Bill's birthday. New emails released by WikiLeaks in connection with its dump of John Podesta's email server indicate that Qatar, an Islamist state in the Persian Gulf, gave former President Bill Clinton a check of $1 million for his birthday. The email indicates foundation officials also met with representatives from Brazil, Peru, Malawi, and Rwanda to discuss donations and philanthropic strategies for the foundation. And of course, they discussed Qatari access to Haiti after the earthquake so they could get all those lucrative contracts. Of course, the people of Haiti absolutely despised the Clintons because they were stabbed in the back and the country was never fixed because they were creaming off these insider deals. Again, Qatar, a country that puts gay people in prison for 5 years, giving Bill Clinton a birthday check for $1 million. Qatar, a country where it's still legal for a husband to beat and rape his wife. How does that wash with Hillary Clinton's feminist campaign platform? The women's rights champion. Her own foundation receiving yet another backhander from a country that imprisons gay people, that legalizes the brutal beatings of women. Explain that one to me, New York Times. No, they're too busy talking about an allegation that Trump touched a woman on a plane 35 years ago. Like, that has any relation whatsoever to what Americans are going through now, to what Haitians are going through now, to the future of the world, war with Russia, all of this stuff leaking every single day, bombshell, relevant, impactful information. They're talking about an allegation of Trump touching a woman on a plane in the 80s. That's why 94% of Americans don't trust the mainstream media. When are you going to get it? I mean, their readership's completely collapsing. You can go onto the comments if they haven't banned them, which they have in most places, on every Washington Post article, on every New York Times article. And again, their narrative is being completely demolished. That's why more and more they're having to band together, communicate, collude to push the same narratives, because people just aren't buying their crap anymore. And that's what's being exposed in the Clinton emails. And this is what we're going to get into after the break. We're going to name one by one these so-called journalists who are actually have been exposed as Clinton campaign surrogates. The same journalists that have, lo and behold, been attacking InfoWars, been attacking me for the past 3-4 months over this campaign. Isn't it a surprise that the most vehement critics of InfoWars, the biggest mudslingers, turn out to be the friendlies within Hillary Clinton's campaign? Well, we're going to expose them. We're going to name them straight ahead on The Alex Jones Show. Breaking news at InfoWars.com. Don't go away. We are live on The Alex Jones Show this Thursday, October 13th edition, with bombshell after bombshell coming out from WikiLeaks, but with The New York Times preferring to report on Trump allegedly touching a woman on a plane in the 80s. They weren't that interested in the video which came out earlier this week of Bill Clinton groping a woman's genitals on a plane. Of course, that happened more recently. How much coverage did that get? None whatsoever. How much coverage did the video of Obama showing off his erection to female staffers on a plane get? How much media play did that get? Virtually none. But some woman who claims, who didn't even tell police at the time, who waited 35 years until it was politically convenient, until it fit the media narrative, she waits that long. A Democratic operative, somebody who's donated to the Democratic Party, somebody, imagine my shock, who supports Hillary Clinton. That's what the New York Times is talking about. They're not talking about the email which came out hours ago now. As of the WikiLeaks release number 6, the Podesta emails, this is an email sent from the Clinton Foundation about Qatar. It says, quote, would like to see William Jefferson Clinton for 5 minutes in New York City to present a $1 million check that Qatar promised for WJC's birthday in 2011. It goes on to say, Qatar would welcome our suggestions for investments in Haiti. Oh, I bet they would. I bet they would. Bill Clinton getting a $1 million birthday backhander from a country that imprisons gay people, from a country where it's still legal for husbands to beat their wives and rape them. That's not going to play very well in the New York Times, is it? So they're not going to tell you about it. Absolutely amazing. Let's get to these new, absolutely damning revelations about Donald Trump. So this is Jessica Leeds, a 74-year-old woman who's talking about an alleged incident that happened 35 years ago. So again, a famous billionaire sexually assaults her on a plane. She doesn't tell police. She doesn't even tell airline staff. She waits 35 years to let us know about this, just conveniently 4 weeks before a national election. Well, what a coincidence. And again, she uses the quote, this is in the New York Times article, which is what they're talking about. They're not talking about anything that actually matters. She says, he was like an octopus. His hands were everywhere. It was an assault. Now, that's interesting because that quote is lifted almost directly word for word from a similar allegation that turned out to be nonsense against an actor called Bill Roach from 2014. Again, his hands were like an octopus. They were everywhere. They lifted almost word for word the exact same quote in this report. Other people are pointing out that it's basically taken straight from a Velvet Underground song. It's not a quote that's regularly used, not a term that's regularly used. There's speculation about this woman accusing Trump of touching her of having the same phone number that is linked back to the Clinton Foundation. That remains to be confirmed, but that's something that we're digging into. And again, at the time she didn't tell the airline staff, didn't tell police, a billionaire sexually assaults her, and she's not even cognizant of the fact that she could get, you know, some financial benefits, some windfall from that at the time. So this morning on Twitter, next fake Trump victim began trending. You will notice on Twitter that the more pro-conservative hashtags start trending in the morning, then they're taken over later on by the leftists, and then the conservatives try and hijack those. But again, this started trending on Twitter, and it comes down to this. The media needs a fresh serving of feigned moral outrage every single day to keep the attention away from these WikiLeaks emails. That's why we're seeing a trickle now every single day. We saw CBS. They dug up a tape from 1992. Again, very relevant to how Americans are living today, what they want for the future of their country. Very relevant. Where Donald Trump is hanging around with a bunch of 10-year-old girls, and he jokes that he might be dating one of them in 10 years. Now, you could call that crass. You can call that a little odd. But how does it compare to somebody accepting $1 million from a country that imprisons homosexuals, that legalizes the rape and beating of women? How does it match up there? How does it match up with Hillary Clinton on tape laughing about how she knew a child molester was guilty, knowing that he had fooled a polygraph test, and laughing about it? How does that match up? And of course, I think it was today or last night, Don Lemon gets up on CNN. They bring it up. They say, well, Hillary Clinton laughed at helping to get a child molester, a rapist, raped 12-year-old Kathy Shelton, left her in a coma for 5 days. Hillary Clinton helped that child molester go free. She's on tape joking about how he passed a lie detector test that she made him take, and that forever destroyed her faith in lie detector tests, meaning he had fooled the test and that he had raped the child. So Don Lemon gets up on CNN and says, our fact checkers looked into that and it's not true. Well, here's a newsflash, Don Lemon. Nobody believes your fact checkers. In fact, they did a study, they did a poll, and I believe it was about 28% of people they asked actually believed the fact checkers. So this is their new tactic. Any single scandal whatsoever about Hillary Clinton, the Clinton campaign comes out and says, oh, it's Russia, just blame it on Russia. Every single email that's come out of these WikiLeaks, oh, it's Russia, it's just Russia, it's all made up. Because they can't acknowledge them, they can't fight them one by one because there are so many of them. It's an absolute deluge. So the Clinton campaign blames Russia. The media says their fact checkers proved it wrong. Well, no one believes your stupid little fact checkers anymore because you've been lying to the American people for years and years and years. And that tends to attract a reputation for distrust. So they're up on CNN, oh, we fact-checked the claim that Hillary laughed about him fooling the lie detector test, the child rapist. It's not true. Well, it is true. She says it destroyed her faith in lie detector tests, the fact that he passed the test. In what universe is that not her knowing that he was lying, that he had raped the child? It's plain as day. But their fact checkers debunked it. It's like Snopes. I mean, how much apologia for Hillary Clinton do we need to see from Snopes.com to realize that this is a hack outfit, incredibly biased? And yet the narrative is still, oh, look, it's on Snopes. It's an urban myth. It's fake. Well, no, Snopes is biased. In fact, we came out with a story on InfoWars a few days ago, again, from these WikiLeaks emails, where they're in there talking about how they need to keep the citizenry unaware and compliant. These are emails between a Democratic surrogate, a Hillary surrogate, and John Podesta saying, we need to keep them unaware, we need to keep them compliant. It's worked up until now, they're still kind of unaware, but they're not being compliant enough. Now, what did Snopes do with that story when they got a hold of it? They took the quote that was in this email, they asked Bill Avey, I think his name was, who made the quote in the email, who sent the email, they asked him what he meant by that. And he said, well, I didn't mean that the American people were unaware, that they were compliant, that we need to keep them this way. I meant something completely different. And they actually allowed him to create a new quote, a new set of sentences to put before and after the quote, the original quote that was in the email, to completely change the context of the quote. I'm sorry, it doesn't work like that. You can't invent new sentences years after the fact to change the context of what a quote means. But it's debunked. It's on Snopes. Snopes is debunked. It's basically a cat lady and her husband in their apartment working for Hillary Clinton. That's not an objective news outlet. And when they invent new sentences, new quotes to put before and after original quotes that change the meaning and the context of the entire passage, that's not an excuse. That's not a debunking. That's deception. That's what Snopes does. And yet, oh, it's so credible. The fact checkers are so credible, even though 28% of Americans actually believe the fact checkers. So no one believes those people either. The vast majority of Americans don't believe them. But again, they live inside their own echo chamber, and it's come back to bite them on the butt with this Rasmussen poll, which shows that Trump is ahead. So again, getting back to these allegations against Trump, a 74-year-old woman on a plane in the 80s says that Donald Trump touched her. No evidence, didn't tell the airline staff, didn't tell the police. Suddenly it emerges, just by coincidence, 4 weeks before the election. Well, imagine my shock. So again, they need this fresh serving of moral outrage every day to counter the WikiLeaks emails, because they can't address the WikiLeaks emails. There's too many of them. There's too many scandals coming out. We're going to get onto some of them later. So they have to keep the public distracted with these phony moral outrage controversies. And of course, you've got the likes of Miley Cyrus coming out. You've got Beyonce coming out, speaking out against Trump. These are the icons of morality in America, right? Miley Cyrus, who parades around to a tween audience with giant inflatable dildos. She's the moral icon for America. She says that what Donald Trump said was disgusting, while she's literally parading on stage to a preteen audience with a giant dildo. Beyonce. People have looked at the lyrics of her songs. Again, cited by Hillary Clinton as a great example to young women. I can't repeat the lyrics on the show here. They're 10 times worse than anything Trump said in those tapes. But these people have been appointed the new moral guardians of America, the most disgusting, nihilistic people you could imagine. And they're being held up as the great example for young women. A girl who prances around on stage with a dildo says that Donald Trump is bad because he said the word pussy in 2005. I mean, come on. So again, getting back to this story, there was another claim with no evidence. From 2005, it was a People magazine journalist who was interviewing Donald Trump, said that Trump forced himself on her in 2005 when she was interviewing him. Trump said the writer didn't mention the incident in her story at the time because it didn't happen, which is quite a good point. If a famous billionaire sexually assaults you and you're a journalist, you would think that might be a big story. It might not just be a big story. It might be a good way of getting financial compensation. But again, she wasn't interested in telling anyone in 2005. Only just by coincidence, she's interested in telling everyone 4 weeks before the election. So this is what we have to deal with on a daily basis now. You know, Hillary armed ISIS. That's come out in the emails. That's proven. Bill Clinton's taking checks from countries that abuse women, that throw gay people in prison. But Donald Trump may have touched a woman on a plane in the 80s. Guess which story the New York Times decides to report on? Well, I don't need to tell you. Again, I don't even call myself a reporter. but I'm having to do the job of self-proclaimed journalists every single day. Either that or they don't know how to search, how to use a search box, because that's basically all you need to do with WikiLeaks. Again, MSM non-coverage. The media's coverage of these WikiLeaks emails, absolutely shameful. But it's no surprise, given what's revealed in the other WikiLeaks emails, which again is the fact that the mainstream media is not only biased towards the Hillary campaign, not only surrogates, but in many cases, coordinating with them. They basically are the Hillary Clinton campaign at this point. And I'm going to give you some examples. I'm going to get more into this after the break here. We've got about 4 minutes left on the Alex Jones Show Live. So you've got John Podesta, Hillary Clinton's campaign chairman, talking about in these emails how he's, quote, cooking for 30 of Hillary's reporter friends. Oh, isn't that lovely? 30 so-called independent, neutral, impartial reporters around the apartment of the Clinton campaign chairman having him cook for them. How is that not collusion? Again, you had that event a while back, which the Daily Caller reported on, where they had 37 journalists from 14 outlets attending an off-the-record cocktail party hosted by the Clinton campaign. ABC, Bloomberg, CBS, CNN, Daily Beast, Huffington Post, MSNBC, NBC, the list goes on and on. At the time, people were saying that could be a one-off. Well, no, it's not a one-off. You've literally got John Podesta, the Clinton campaign chairman, cooking dinner for 30 so-called impartial reporters in his apartment. Nobody's even reported on this yet. Again, I saw this yesterday in the WikiLeaks releases, didn't even have time to write an article on it. I don't believe anyone has so far. There's so much information coming out that people can't write articles quick enough. And because the mainstream media refuses to cover it. That's why we're having to do their job. Another example, John Harwood, CNBC, who was actually a debate moderator, showering Hillary with praise. He describes the story he is writing about Hillary as one, quote, she wants. He's bombarding the Hillary campaign with these emails, acting like an obedient lapdog, showering her with praise, again, demanding their favor. Writing an article that Hillary Clinton wants. He's pandering to them. Donna Brazile, the current head of the Democratic National Committee, then working with CNN, tipped off Hillary that there'd be a death penalty question at the town hall debate the next day. Gave Hillary Clinton the question in advance. The one thing you're not supposed to do according to those debate rules. They asked her about this. They asked if it was true, the Daily Caller. Donna Brazile responded by blaming Russia. Again, they can't even acknowledge or respond to the individual emails, so they're just using this tactic of saying, oh, it's all Vladimir Putin, inventing their own vast conspiracy theory as an excuse to dismiss this without acknowledging the fact that it's authentic. In fact, Hillary acknowledged that they were authentic during the debate, but they're still doing this because they don't want to address the scandals. Again, CNN now has the temerity to come out that, say, a crowd at a Donald Trump event chanting CNN sucks is dangerous. Meanwhile, they're literally handing Hillary Clinton the questions before the debate. You had the Boston Globe's op-ed editor, Marjorie Pritchard, promising to write a positive article to give Hillary a, quote, big presence right before an appearance in New Hampshire. Yet another example of the Clinton campaign and the media complex working hand in hand to get Hillary Clinton elected. This is why they're not writing about the Podesta emails. They're completely in bed with them. We're going to go into more names after the break. We're going to go name by name the journalists who have proven themselves to be complete intellectual cowards, sellouts. And that's why you're not reading about these kind of stories in the New York Times. That's why they continue to distract you. We'll be back on the next segment of The Alex Jones Show, Infowars.com. Stay right there. We are live on The Alex Jones Show. Before we get back to the news, and Stefan Molyneux is coming up in the next hour, Just want to remind you that we're not funded by Qatar or Saudi Arabia. We don't get $1 million checks from countries that throw gay people in jail or abuse women, unlike Bill Clinton, unlike the Clinton Foundation. We don't get checks from the government of Bahrain like CNN does. We don't get funded by giant pharmaceutical companies. We don't get funded to the tune of hundreds of millions of dollars like Black Lives Matter does from George Soros. We're funded by you, the listener. And yet we're competing with these powerful groups on an even footing. They're panicked, completely panicked about the influence we're having, about the narratives that we're dismantling on a daily basis. And we couldn't have done it without your support. I mean, remember where we started off? Alex Jones and his VHS tapes back in the late 90s. You know, basically two staff members, Alex Jones, and that was it. Now look at where we've got to. And it's solely because of your support. And that's why we need you to continue supporting us by getting the products at InfoWarsStore.com, where we have the InfoWars solar base station power supply now 33% off retail. From our research, the InfoWars solar base station power supply is the most affordable and high-powered solar generator out there. And now we're giving you 33% off this solar base station at InfoWarsStore.com to help you get prepared while supplies last. And it would probably be a pretty good idea to get your hands on one of these, given what's happening geopolitically, given that Russia is now advising its citizens to return home, as top US military chiefs talk about war with Russia, as Hillary Clinton says that if there's no evidence whatsoever even of a hack of emails, even if it's just blamed on Russia, then the US would use military assets against Russia. That's kind of concerning, isn't it? So a good reason to stock up on these emergency supplies just in case. Again, it's okay for the government to have vast supplies of storable food. If we do it, we're kooks, though. But you can get the InfoWars solar base station power supply 33% off retail at InfoWarsStore.com, along with all the great products that we have there, the five-star independent reviews. And again, we don't get cut $1 million checks from governments that throw gay people in jail and abuse women, unlike Bill Clinton, unlike the Clinton Foundation, which is why we need your support by getting the products at InfoWarsStore.com. Now, we've got about 90 seconds left in this segment, but we're going to get more into this after the break. We're naming, we're calling out, we're exposing the cucked journalists who are working for Hillary Clinton. Now, we've gone down the list. Boston Globe, Marjorie Pritchard. We've gone Donna Brazile, former CNN, John Harwood, again, begging the Clinton campaign, praising Hillary. Oliver Darcy, here's another one who attacks me on a regular basis. Business Insider. How was the Business Insider described in these WikiLeaks Hillary Podesta emails? It was described as one of Hillary's friendlies. One of their friendlies. So again, everything, anything you see in the Business Insider, not independent, not impartial, they're a Hillary Clinton campaign surrogate. Hunter Walker, again, Business Insider, now at Yahoo News, was described as a friendly when he was at the Business Insider by Clinton traveling press secretary Nick Merrill. Dan Merrick works for CNN. Yes, that's his actual name. Again, a couple of days ago, he was whining about us paying people to protest Bill Clinton with the Bill Clinton rape protest. Again, he's listed in these emails as a Hillary campaign surrogate, saying that him and Hillary Clinton love each other. This is the supposed impartial mainstream media. We're exposing them, we're naming them for what they are, which is Hillary Clinton prostitutes. We'll be back with the second hour of The Alex Jones Show, InfoWars.com. Don't go away. We are live. It's the second hour of The Alex Jones Show, and we're talking about the prostitutes that have been exposed in the WikiLeaks emails as being Clinton campaign surrogates. These people need to be called out. They need to be named. We've gone through several so far. Let's continue. Louise Mensch. Louise Mensch is a former Conservative Party member. She moved over to America. She tried to proclaim herself to be a conservative, to be an anti-SJW. About 6 months ago, she went completely insane and became one of these Never Trump people. A few weeks ago, started attacking me directly on Twitter, claiming that I was commanding the mythical Putin troll bot army as one of the leaders of the alt-right, and that I was individually controlling all these Twitter accounts to amplify my own anti-Hillary message. Well, I have trouble even checking my own Twitter notifications, so it would probably be difficult for me to control hundreds or thousands of other Twitter accounts. Now, she also claimed that anyone who retweeted me was part of the Putin troll bot army. She actually had retweeted me 6 days before that, so by proxy that meant that she was part of the Putin troll bot army, which only exists in her head, in her mythical imagination. She was completely exposed. This was hilarious. Louise Mensch, who works for Heat Street, which is a Murdoch publication, and by the way, I'm getting contacted by her colleagues saying how embarrassed they are about her behavior. She was exposed for sending this tepid fangirl email to the Hillary Clinton campaign where she literally begs them, and she actually writes a Hillary campaign ad saying how much Hillary loves women, because as we know, she doesn't laugh at rapists getting off molesting 12-year-old children. You know, she doesn't get off intimidating Juanita Broderick, intimidating Bill Clinton's rape victims. No, she's the champion of women's rights. So Louise Mensch actually writes an ad campaign for Hillary, sends it to Podesta. Podesta says it's good, it's great. She's very smart, she's very intelligent. Now it's been exposed, and Louise Mensch is basically finished. What was even funnier, she reacted to this by threatening to sue WikiLeaks and Julian Assange for hacking her email. Okay, number one, it's not in the jurisdiction of the United Kingdom, so what the hell is she talking about? Number two, they didn't hack her email. WikiLeaks didn't hack anyone's email. They were given the information by whoever did hack them. Louise Mensch's email was not hacked. She merely sent an email to the Clinton campaign, which was revealed as part of the hack of John Podesta's emails. So again, she's being exposed. Dan Merica, Hunter Walker, Oliver Darcy, Marjorie Pritchard, we're naming them. New York Times Magazine chief national correspondent Mark Lebovich is described as sympathetic. And remember, it also came out that the New York Times was begging the Clinton campaign to use quotes that they had got from their own interview with Hillary Clinton. That shows you how cooked they really are. The New York Times does an interview with Hillary Clinton, and after the fact, after it's already taped, recorded, and in the can, they then have to email the Clinton campaign and ask, coordinate, beg to use quotes that were made by Clinton during the interview. Again, that shows you how beholden, how cooked they are to the Hillary Clinton campaign. Why they're talking about Trump allegedly touching a woman on a plane in the 80s and not about these massive WikiLeaks bombshells that come out by the minute. That is why the media is controlled. That's why the Fourth Estate is dead. That's why 94% of Americans distrust the mainstream media. And there's going to be more revelations coming out soon. They're coming out by the minute. We can't even keep up with them, which is why the mainstream media has to consistently dole out fresh servings of feigned moral outrage over what Trump allegedly said or did with no evidence 35 years ago. We'll be back on the Alex Jones Show live with Stefan Molyneux. Don't go away, Infowars.com. This is Paul Joseph Watson in for Alex Jones. We're going to go to our guest here in a minute, Stefan Molyneux. First, I wanted to get to this story, which is incredibly important. This is out of Vocative. The headline, want $5,000, call Bill Clinton a rapist on national television. And indeed, several people have. The ongoing rape stunts have electrified many Trump supporters and conservative media consumers enough to compete with the interest generated from the latest misogynistic bombshell consuming a Republican nominee. Now, did you get that? That meme, Bill Clinton is a rapist, which of course has been splayed across Hillary, Tim Kaine, Al Gore events for the past 2 weeks across television, is, quote, enough to compete with the so-called fallout from these Trump tapes. And this article drills into the statistics to prove that. This is not Infowars.com. This is a mainstream article. Quote, Clinton's rape accusations have been mentioned over 872,000 times on Twitter in the last 13 days since Jones announced his bounty. evocative analysis found. By contrast, social media users shared the hashtag Trump tape some 975,000 times in the days since a leaked NBC tape revealed Trump talking about grabbing women. So again, the Bill Clinton rape protest continues day by day. It will build. We've got some more plans that we're going to reveal for it in the coming days. It's matching the so-called damaging fallout from these Trump tapes. Just that one meme alone launched by Alex Jones, launched by Infowars.com. That tells you why the Clinton campaign is terrified that this is going to continue. And it's not only going to continue, it's going to build. They're absolutely petrified of it because it's competing for media attention, social media attention. It's splashed across cable broadcast news. And they're not happy about that. They wanted the entire narrative to be about how Donald Trump's this evil misogynist, saying terrible things, doing terrible things to women. It's not quite working out for them, as we saw with the Rasmussen poll. And tonight on Fox News, we're told more of Bill Clinton's rape accusers will appear live on Fox News tonight. Stephen Bannon, the CEO of the Trump campaign, said, quote, "We're going to turn him," meaning Bill Clinton, "into Bill Cosby." So if the Clinton campaign thought that they had seized the initiative with this narrative that they're controlling it, this abuse of women narrative by focusing on Donald Trump, by things that women allege happened on a plane in the 80s with no evidence, then they've got another thing coming. And that's why the Clinton campaign is petrified about the Bill Clinton is a rapist protest that is sweeping the country right now. I'm going to go to our guest, Stefan Molyneux, who, of course, needs no introduction. He's been on the show before. I've been on his show several times. The website is freedomainradio.com. Stefan, welcome to the show.
Thanks, Paul. It's great to be here.
Now, first, I want to get into these latest allegations against Trump. Of course, we'll move on to the WikiLeaks stuff. But, you know, we don't expect the New York Times to be interested in Hillary arming ISIS, which came out of the WikiLeaks bombshell releases. But, you know, some woman on a plane claims that Donald Trump touched her in the 80s with no evidence. She told no one about it at the time, didn't tell the airline staff. She waits 35 years until 4 weeks before the election to tell anyone about this. Isn't that an amazing coincidence?
Well, and I talked about this at the time when you saw Anderson Cooper confronting Trump in the last debate saying, "Have you ever touched any other women inappropriately, ever, anywhere, ever?" And of course, Trump said no. And immediately you knew they had a lineup of accusers down the road coming up to do this kind of stuff. And it is tragic and it is kind of predictable. And it does show, I think, the degree of collusion that WikiLeaks is pointing out between the mainstream media, the sort of propaganda arm of the Democrat Party, and what is going on in politics. And dear Lord above, Paul, wouldn't it be really, really, really nice if we had a slightly more elevated debate than, "You're a rapist. No, you're a rapist. No, you're a rapist." I mean, we're not talking Churchill here. We're not talking the Lincoln-Douglas debates. This is like grade two screaming that is going on, and it is being dragged down to that level by the Clinton campaign, in my opinion.
I mean, is that a wise decision to drag it down, though? Because, you know, you've got Joe Biden on tape physically groping kids, young girls, you know, whispering in their ear. You've got Obama showing off his erection on a plane. You've got Bill Clinton on video touching a woman's genitals on a plane. You've got Bill Clinton's entire history of being a sexual predator towards women. Did they really think they could drag it down to this level and come off on top, given the baggage that's connected to Hillary Clinton in this specific area?
Well, this is a sort of decap boomerang, right? You use a weapon you think you're going to throw at other people, but it's going to come back and do nasty things to your particular person. Of all of the attacks that you'd want to take on another person, if Bill Clinton was anywhere in the vicinity, of all the attacks you'd want to take, sexual impropriety would be way, way, way down at the bottom of the list, because that really is like, it's a grenade that you pull the pin and it's stuck to your hand, and it's stuck to your hand because of all of the things, this is the one that the Clintons are most vulnerable on. Because, you know, there's lots of stories of their corruption and the Clinton cash kind of stuff. But that stuff's kind of abstract for a lot of people. It's kind of hard to follow. But this particular one, where you have line after line after line of women claiming rape and sexual assault and sexual harassment and so on. And it is settled a lawsuit for over $800,000 with Paula Jones. So of all the things that you'd want to bring up, sexual impropriety would be the least valuable and the most dangerous, which I think should give us all hope that this is where they're at. This is the bottom of the barrel that they're scraping. This is how desperate they are, and this is how little they have on Trump.
Well, there have been rumblings in both directions that more tapes are coming out. We'll see how damaging they are. We had a claim from a hacker that there's a racist Hillary Clinton tape coming out, which remains sounds too good to be true to me, but we'll see if that emerges. You know, Stefan, we had JFK, serial womanizer, Bill Clinton, serial sex offender, sex abuser, Ted Kennedy killed a woman. Isn't it amazing that, you know, leftists and Democrats only care about people in politics being abusive towards women when they're running as Republicans? There doesn't seem to be that much concern when it's Democrats.
Oh, man, watching the selective outrage of people on the left about sexual impropriety is like me auditioning for the after photo of the Hair Club for Men. It just doesn't make any sense at all. But this is the kind of projection that generally occurs on the left. They will generally accuse you of what is deep within their own secret hearts, and it is more a revelation of their own particular impulses than anything objectively that's happening in the world. I mean, the idea that Donald Trump, back in the, the 80s, like 30-plus years ago, recently married to his wife, a 34-year-old playboy billionaire, that this woman is going, he's just going to start randomly groping women on airplanes in full view of everyone. Well, that's not particularly believable. Another thing that, you know, just by the by, I've done a lot of flying, particularly for business, and I've almost never gone first class because, you know, it was my company, I want to save the money. But, you know, getting to first class from coach, not the easiest thing in the world. I think they're going to electrify that particular curtain and put up bars or whatever. Maybe Trump could build a wall between coach and first class. But I think her story is that she was invited up into first class by the stewardess. And, you know, I have, I don't know how many hundreds of flights under my belt. And the idea that you're just going to get invited up into first class, I mean, never seen it, never happened. Can you imagine? What do? Whisper up to someone, hey, you want to come up into first class? Don't tell anyone else. I mean, this doesn't happen. And she contradicted herself several times in the story itself. And there's no evidence. There's no witnesses. Plus, of course, if she had these kinds of goods on Donald Trump, if he had groped her and so on, she could have taken him to court. She could have got a settlement. She could have gotten rich. But no. She sits on it for over three decades and then finally goes public just a couple of weeks before the election. And this should be, I think, evidence of, again, how desperate and how empty their quiver is if this is the stuff they're throwing at him.
I mean, isn't it just going to end up discrediting the media more? We can get into talking about this poll, but if this is proven to have no evidence behind it whatsoever, and now Trump's got his lawyers to write the letter threatening a lawsuit if there's a retraction, do you think there will be a retraction? Do you think this will just end up discrediting the media more and then kind of making them lose ammunition for future Trump attacks in the same vein?
Yeah, I mean, I got to tell you, Paul, I keep thinking that the media is going to back down from this brinksmanship that they're playing. I mean, this, especially, you know, with these Podesta emails coming out, and as you've been talking about in the show, the degree of collusion between reporters and the Clinton campaign, I mean, it's crazy. I mean, it's been suspected for a long time, but of course now the facts are really coming out. So the media, of course, has a lot of some credibility left with people. It's got a lot of investment. It's got a lot of infrastructure. And are they actually going to just burn the whole damn thing to the ground in order to try and get Hillary Clinton into the White House? Well, I don't think they're going to retract. I don't think they're going to apologize. I mean, what was it? Was it the New York Times where the guy said he was willing to go to jail just to leak Donald Trump's tax returns? And the reason for that, of course, is that this is it. This is the election that determines the future of Western civilization, i.e. whether it has one or whether it doesn't have one. It all comes down to this. If Trump gets in and does what he says he's going to do in terms of deporting or allowing for the self-deportation of tens of millions of illegal immigrants, and if he builds the wall and so on, then the entire voting base that the Democrats was relying on legitimizing, on granting citizenship to, in order to have them vote, you know, 80, 85% Democrat until the end of time, that entire voting base that the Democrats are counting on to never have to actually have a debate about policy in the future, that's going to be pulled out. If that's pulled out, the Democrats are literally crippled for, I would guess, at least a generation. And so they don't have anything to lose, because if Trump gets in, I think the mainstream media doesn't have a master to serve anymore, doesn't have an audience that's going to care about what they say. So I think this is why they're willing to put absolutely everything on the line, willing to burn down what remains of their credibility just... Okay.
We're back live with Stefan Molyneux, talking about the latest massive Trump scandal by the mainstream media, that he allegedly, with no evidence, touched a woman on a plane in the 80s, and that's more important than Hillary Clinton arming ISIS, of course. More important than anything that relates to actual Americans, how they're living and working now, about the future of the country. But that's what we've been reduced to talking about, while they completely ignore bombshell after bombshell coming out of the Podesta emails. Stefan, one of the things about this which really rankles me is this newfound moral authority that the left seems to have ascribed to itself. You know, we had Ann Coulter last month, I think it was, at the Comedy Central roast, being called the C word 19 times. We've got, you know, people like Anderson Cooper on CNN using the phrase teabagging over and over again, giggling about it. We've got Miley Cyrus, who is really outraged about the sexist, misogynistic, gross comments made by Donald Trump. This is literally someone who parades around on stage to a preteen audience wearing a giant dildo. Miley Cyrus, okay, she's the new moral authority. You know, you've got Jake Tapper going on CNN and saying, oh, not only have I never said anything like Trump said, I've never heard anyone else say it in my life. I mean, anyone who claims that they haven't heard a conversation where the opposite sex is joking about sexual objectification is a liar. I mean, we know what girls talk about. You overhear girls' conversations between them. It's very often quite graphic. Anyone who claims they've never heard, maybe not said, but even so, never heard conversations in the same manner as what we heard on the Trump tapes is just a liar. And it's this feigned moral outrage from the left that really rankles me, Stefan, because they haven't got a leg to stand on, have they?
Well, it's worse than that. I mean, so the left, of course, the mainstream media seems to have had quite a bit of trouble reporting the actual groping of women in Germany during the Cologne New Year's and other things. They seem to have quite a bit of trouble actually reporting pedophiles at, or a pedophile, Seville, at the BBC. They seem to have had a lot of trouble actually reporting the countless Pakistani gang rapes of young white British girls, over 1,000 in Rotherham alone, not to mention dozens of other cities in England. So they sure don't seem to have much luck getting out narratives about genuine sexual predation. Of course, they have, as you pointed out, bypassed the whole Bill Clinton thing for many, many decades. And so the idea that now suddenly they've got this huge concern about any kind of sexual impropriety, it is pure politics. And what I find so vile about all of this, Paul, there are genuine victims of both sexes of genuine sexual assault, sexual abuse, sexual harassment, and rape, and so on. And to hook your political narrative into what people really care about, and it's an actual heinous crime, just to get into power, just to smear an opponent, is to me a true horrifying manipulation of genuine evil and genuine human suffering, all in the pursuit of political power. And of course, when this stuff seems to get discredited quite regularly, right? I mean, all the way back to the Duke Lacrosse case, all the way back to some aspects of the Mattress Girl case, all the way back to the UVA rape, all the way back to all of these things, as they get progressively discredited because they're being used to advance the political narrative, the genuine victims of rape and sexual abuse are going to find it harder and harder and harder to be believed. And this, I think, is one of the greatest evils, is the mining of legitimate evil and human suffering for the sake of a pursuit of political power.
I mean, the media has become expert at peddling rape hoaxes. I mean, right up to the President of the United States claiming that 1 in 5 women on college campuses are raped. Again, that statistic has been debunked over and over again, yet they still claim it. They're the experts, the mainstream media is, in concocting fake rape stories, fake sexual abuse stories. And as you said, they're also the experts in ignoring real ones. So how could we even trust them to begin with? You mentioned Rotherham again. Over the course of over a decade, I think it was about 13 years, thousands of young girls trafficked, abused, raped by these Pakistani paedophile gangs. Not only did they not report on it, the people in government covered it up because they were afraid of being politically incorrect. They were afraid of being called racist. They actually went to the victims, demonized, blamed the victims of this child abuse, told them they were lying, and that these individuals had done nothing wrong whatsoever. It continued in numerous towns and cities across the United Kingdom. It's still continuing to this day. And again, as you said, nobody cares about that. The media in Germany, for days after the Cologne mass molestation, none of them dared report on it, even though it had come out already days before in social media. We're going to get more into this and the latest WikiLeaks bombshells after the break with Stefan Molyneux. Again, these revelations are coming in minute by minute. Was what's going to be next. But we can be assured that the New York Times is not going to talk about it. We'll be back on the Alex Jones Show live, Infowars.com. It's Paul Joseph Watson in for Alex Jones. David Knight is going to be hosting the next hour. But before we go back to our guest, Stefan Molyneux, I want to tell you about Biome Defense, the first ever probiotic from InfowarsLife.com. And again, we don't get handed $1 million checks from the government of Qatar that throws gay people in jail and allows husbands to beat and rape their wives. We're not the Clinton Foundation. We don't get hundreds of millions of dollars from George Soros like Black Lives Matter. We don't get checks from the government of Bahrain like CNN does. We have to kind of make our own way by selling products that people like, that they enjoy, that they buy, they re-up over and over again, and they leave five-star reviews about at InfowarsLife.com. I know it's terrible. God forbid we should actually fund and maintain our own operation. Maybe we should just take checks from George Soros and the government of Qatar, but we can't do that right now, so we rely on your support by getting the products at InfowarsLife.com. Biome Defense by Infowars Life is a superior blend of 50 billion live and active cultures from 23 different probiotic strains, which are known to support digestion and intestinal function. The experts agree that gut health plays a huge role in the normal function of your immune system, and it's essential for optimum health. And again, go on the website, InfowarsLife.com, see the independent five-star reviews. This is how you support us in the fight. This is how we build the platform. This is how we take on the mainstream media narrative directly. And you see how we do that. We're completely transparent. We send reporters out to the field to challenge these narratives. We sent Joe Biggs and Owen Schroeder, I believe, down to Haiti to do work there, exposing the Clinton Foundation, helping out on the charitable side of things again. That's all because of your support. We would not be able to do that if you didn't get the products at InfowarsLife.com. So go and check out Biome Defense by Infowars Life at InfowarsLife.com. Now, Stefan Molyneux, going back to the WikiLeaks issue, you know, people were expecting this kind of knockout blow October surprise. That didn't happen. That's not how WikiLeaks operates. We've seen more of the, you know, guerrilla warfare style attack method with this Podesta WikiLeaks email release, a kind of drip, sustained information offensive. To your mind, what are the most damaging revelations we've seen thus far?
Well, of course, the fact that Hillary Clinton her organizations are taking money from Saudi Arabia and Qatar, which she identifies as providing logistical and material support to ISIS. That seems pretty important. But the number one thing for me, Paul, and it hasn't been talked about that much, but let me read you something very briefly that came out, right? So this is John Anzalone. He's a researcher emailing John Podesta. It's a message titled, "You Call It." This is July 15th, 2015. Now, he's quoting Senator Mark Kirk, the Republican from Illinois, who himself is quoted by BuzzFeed. This is regarding the nuclear deal reached with Iran. This is the quote he includes when emailing Podesta. "This agreement," the Iran agreement, "this agreement condemns the next generation to cleaning up a nuclear war in the Persian Gulf. This is the greatest appeasement since Chamberlain gave Czechoslovakia to Hitler." Now, that is as strong a condemnation of a particular deal as can be conceivably imagined. The idea that the deal might lead to a nuclear war, destroying the region, killing millions, raining blood and sand and oil down across the world, darkening the sunsets for half a generation, this is a pretty strong condemnation. So, you call it, is emailed to John Podesta regarding this nuclear war issue. John Podesta responded, yep. Yep. What does that mean? Does that mean, I think that means he agrees that this is going to lead to a nuclear war in the Persian Gulf. That seems to me, call me crazy, call me out of right field, but that seems to me just a little bit more important than a he said, she said grope on an airplane 3+ decades ago.
And again, this is the point I make over and over again. You've got the Qatar thing today. You've got, you know, the Clinton camp discussing deleting emails despite knowing it was against the law. That came out. You've got, again, more slurs against Catholics, Southerners, needy Latinos. You've got Huma Abedin saying, can we survive not answering questions? That explains the whole lack of a press conference for months and months and months. You've got absolute bombshell after bombshell. You would think for journalists that this would be all their Christmases come at once, an absolute treasure trove. I mean, just in the limited time that I've had to dig through these emails, I've got several exclusives out of it that nobody else had by simply, you know, asking people to send me what they thought was important, writing an article about it. Yet we've seen virtually nothing from the big media organizations. All they're doing is regurgitating this debunked claim that, oh, just blame Russia. Just blame Russia so we don't have to even address the details of these emails. I mean, are you surprised at the sheer depth of media collusion? I mean, we knew they were in bed with each other, but the sheer depth of the croniness, it's even surprised me. Are you shocked by it?
I think it's escalated in the past decade or so. Like, as we know, Carlos Slim, a guy who's heavily involved in cell phone sales in Mexico, he wants a whole bunch of money coming from people who were Mexicans in America, the remittances going back to Mexico. Mexican government as a whole, remittances are worth even more for them than their oil trade. So Carlos Slim, of course, owns a significant portion of the New York Times, and so he's going to oppose these kinds of closed borders, having a wall and so on. So I think there is a kind of predictability, but again, the stakes have never been higher. I myself have wanted this fight since I was about 20. Let's just say that's quite a few years at this point. I have wanted this fight. I have wanted people to take on the media. I have wanted people to take on the Clintons. I have wanted people to forcefully go into this leftist nest and expose it for what it is. Finally, it is happening, baby. It is happening right before our eyes. I am springing out of bed like a caffeine catapult to work this kind of stuff during the day, because it has all come down to this. My whole life has prepared me for this. This is the moment. This is the time when people need to act. We need to start having an honest conversation about facts, not screams of racism, not screams of sexism and homophobia and all this, that, and the other. We need to have a reasoned discourse about facts. And now everybody understands the media is in the way to people having a coherent conversation. The journalism that is occurring now, as you're pointing out, Paul, it's happening through Reddit. It's happening through 4chan. It's happening through Twitter. The reporters are abandoning their posts, and volunteers, unpaid volunteers, are combing through this stuff. People like you and I are bringing it to the attention of the masses. It is a new dawn. It is a new day. We finally have the chance to bypass the gatekeepers, deal directly with the people, and bring the information they need directly to their neofrontal cortex for the first time in history. And by God, it is an exhilarating time to be alive, to be in contact with the planet. And I just, for those who are losing hope and so on, snap out of it. We've never had a better chance to get the facts across than we have now. Get moving, get engaged, get sharing information. Don't give up, because that's a self-fulfilling prophecy. The left wants to demoralize you and, oh, we can't win and it's over and so on. Forget all of that. Snap out of it. Give yourself a Don Corleone full-on smack across the face. Get out there and get busy, because if it's not now, it's never.
I mean, it's amazing, Stefan. I guess we should thank these reporters, these journalists, for leaving such a vacuum. I mean, I'll give you an example. About a year ago, not even a year ago, probably, I was on about 10, 11, 12 million Twitter impressions a month. This is people who see your tweets total per each 28-day period. So it went from 11, 12 million a month. Now it's at 120 million Twitter impressions a month. So for each 28-day period, my tweets are seen 120 million times, and it just keeps going up. That is more than a lot of quite big websites get for a month, just my tweets alone. That's not even including YouTube, Facebook, Infowars.com. And of course, I guess you're doing similar numbers now. So, I mean, I guess we should thank them. They've left such a vacuum. They've failed to do their job in every instance. People are so hungry for the truth that now our platforms are just exploding because we're there standing in the gap doing their job for them.
Absolutely. You know, if the horse and buggy manufacturers don't want to upgrade and we're inventing the car, good. You know, just keep making your horse and buggy stuff. That's totally fine because we'll just overstep you. And I think this aspect of things is really, really important. You know, when there's indications that Hillary got certain debate questions ahead of time, when there's indications that she was just, you know, absorbing and borging Bernie Sanders' positions for the sake of political gain. And this goes on and on. I've done a bunch of presentations about this, and people can check this out if they want at youtube.com/freedomainradio. But when all of this stuff is going on, this is all falling apart. The mainstream narrative, which the media has controlled since the dawn of time, since the dawn of the media, the mainstream narrative has been controlled by the gatekeepers. And even in the last election cycle, alternative media wasn't nearly as powerful as it is now. We didn't have the credibility. We didn't have the reach. Now, I'm sure you get the same messages. People say to me, when something goes on in the world, I come to you. The idea that they're going to turn on the news or go to some mainstream media website and think they're going to get anything other than leftist propaganda is incomprehensible to most people. And so the fact that we're building credibility while they're losing credibility, well, there's only one way that that can end up, which is, we take over.
Well, exactly. I mean, even following live news events, we saw it with the truck attack, the terrorist attack. It was the terrorist that carried out, not the truck, in Nice, where you tried to follow that unfolding event on television news. You were just an hour or so behind on the actual details. Following live news events, the best way to do it is on Twitter. That's where you get the most up-to-date information. Again, that's why they're trying to censor us. James O'Keefe has a bunch of videos coming out every day. They blocked his Twitter account. But again, you need to go out into the battleground, onto their field, into their environment. Otherwise, you're just going to be preaching to the choir. And like you said, I mean, people just come straight to us whenever, you know, any big breaking news event happens. I get messages every day from people thanking me, saying they were SJWs, they were leftists, I woke them up. So it's working, but you have to get out on the battleground, on the field. You can't just preach to the choir. But in the final 5 minutes here, Stefan, I just wanted to get on to, you know, the Trump campaign in general. We've got a new Rasmussen poll today, which is showing Trump ahead 43% to 41%. Rasmussen tends to use a fair sample when it comes to polling Democrats and Republicans, unlike the other polling organizations. Stefan, I thought that Trump was finished. I thought that his campaign was completely collapsed and that he would have to step down. Now we've got a poll showing he's ahead. I mean, what's going on?
Well, people are dealing with facts rather than spin. You know, one of the things, this is just a little rant I have stuck in me like a fishbone, so I'll just cough it up on your show if you don't mind. But, you know, one thing that really, really bothers me is there's some non-story that comes out like, oh, no, Trump referred to colloquial cat 11 years ago in a bus that he didn't even know he was being recorded on, probably. And this apparently submits. And so what happens is the media pumps this and pumps this and pumps this and pumps this. You know, like recently you tweeted just like how much the mainstream media was talking about Trump tapes and how little they were talking about WikiLeaks. It was many, many multiples of times that they were talking about the inconsequential story of the Trump tapes. So they pump this story, they pump this story, they pump this story. And then what happens is they say, you know, in a debate or wherever they're at, they say, well, you know, I have to ask you this because it's a really popular topic. It's like, no kidding, it's a popular topic. If you keep repeating the same topic over and over and over again, guess what? People are going to end up talking about it. But it's this kind of circular, reflective nonsense that is going on. And people are waking up to it. They're recognizing that this is not facts. This is all spin. And if you want to go to the facts, you have to go to people who follow the facts. You've built your reputation on giving people the truth, on correcting where information is wrong. I've built my reputation on that commitment to the truth. And that now has become the source of our success, the source of our revenue. And if you want to follow the money, you go to the people who are getting paid to tell the truth, right? Who benefits? Well, you tell more truth, you get more followers, you get more listeners, you get more revenue, you have more impact. So people need to understand that the credibility shift is completely changed. And I think this election, it's never going back. Well, if Hillary gets in, I think we're working as hard, I think, as we can to bring more facts to the people about all this kind of stuff. The narrative is never going back the way it was. That Rubicon has been crossed. And I think that the credibility we're gaining and the followers that we're gaining and the impact that we're having is so powerful that there's no return to the way that things were.
Well, I mean, that's good. I mean, you've got CNN up there yesterday, petrified, saying, how dare Trump supporters chant CNN sucks? Isn't that dangerous? Isn't it such a danger for Trump to encourage that? Well, no, they're chanting you suck because you actually suck. You've lied about things for years. That's why you've got 96%, 94% distrust levels. I mean, that's been exposed. You know, CNN Brazil, the reports are giving Hillary the question before the town hall debate. That's why they're chanting you suck. Not because they're dangerous, not because they're going to suddenly set fire to CNN Center in Atlanta or wherever. It's because you suck. You failed to do your job. That's why we're gaining such a big audience. That's why, you know, you saw it, as I mentioned earlier, this Trump tape discussion on social media has been matched by discussion about Bill Clinton is a rapist protesters. Now, you're talking about the entire mainstream media aligned with a common narrative. The whole legacy media pushing this Trump tape, and we still managed to match them in terms of social media conversation just by encouraging people to go out and say that Bill Clinton is a rapist to wear the T-shirt. Just our organization alone matched them on that, and that's why they're petrified about it. One other question I want to ask you is, you know, we see this desperation. Even after this Trump tape came out, they seem to be getting even more desperate to push this narrative, despite them saying that Hillary is easily ahead. Do you think that their internal polling, not these rigged polls that we've seen, suggests that it's a lot closer than they're letting on? Is that why they seem to be just as desperate as they always have been, if not more?
I think that their internal polls are showing either that it's very close or that Trump is, as you talked about with the Rasmussen poll, slightly ahead. And I think this is really, really important for people to understand. This is not a done deal. I don't care how high Trump gets in the polls. It is still a choice that people have to make to get registered, to get out and vote and to share information and to talk to people, challenge people in your life, bring the facts. So, you know, I do this in my private conversations. You know, I'm up here in Canada, so let's just say it's not exactly a pro-Trump bastion. And I have to have conversations with people where I point out Hillary Clinton's record in the Middle East and I point out Bill Clinton's history with women and all of these kinds of things. Mostly people are unaware of it. You know, give people the facts and they make better decisions. There's an old Socratic argument that evil is a form of ignorance and support for evil is a form of ignorance. Evil always tries to portray itself as good. Bring the facts and people can make better decisions because it really does come down to the next couple of weeks. This is, and I get these messages all the time from people who aren't in America saying, well, I can't vote, but what can I do? Well, find people in America and get the information to them. Share and go to various groups that are in America and share the information with them, groups who otherwise might not get the facts that are out there. Do all of this kind of work. If you're not in America, I'm not in America, there's an enormous amount that you can do to bring real facts to people so they can make more informed and better decisions. So, yeah, I think that they are falling apart or falling behind in the polls. And I think that's because they are just torching their credibility in such a hysterical fashion. And we are breaking down the narrative, breaking apart the propaganda in real time. They don't know how to adapt because they're so used to having this kind of incredible power. They don't know how to change. They don't know how to handle alternative media. And that's why
we'll be back.
We're spreading.
Stefan Molyneux, stay there. Last segment coming up. We'll be back to finish up Infowars.com. Now go away. Final segment of this hour on the Alex Jones Show. We've got Stefan Molyneux. Just want to mention before I get off the air here, I'm sure David Dyke will be covering this. We've got huge developments on Russia. America plotting to allow 9,000 ISIS fighters to escape terror capital Mosul so they can attack Russian troops. Moscow outrageously claims, was it outrageous that the Obama White House gave ISIS a 45-minute warning before bombing their oil tankers? No, that happened. So it doesn't really sound that outrageous, does it, that they would be giving them a warning, a safe passage out of there to go and accomplish the mission that was the purpose of this intervention from the very beginning, which was regime change in Syria by any means possible, which is what led to the rise of ISIS in the first place, as you saw in the WikiLeaks emails. Reuters is reporting Putin ally tells Americans, vote Trump or face nuclear war. That is all escalating. I'm sure David Knight will be able to get into it in the next hour. But Stefan Molyneux, final few minutes here. Closing comments on Trump, on the state of the election race, and tell people how they can get your podcast and about your YouTube channel.
Oh, thanks. Well, it is the choice, I think, between an outsider, a non-politician, who is not beholden to special interest groups, because, of course, he's been funding his own campaign. And I thought it was a wonderful moment in the second debate where he challenged Hillary Clinton to put some of her own, I would consider, fairly ill-gotten gains for these speeches that were nothing burgers but paid $225,000 for telling people nonsense, to dump some of her own money into her campaign. Because, of course, if you spend money on your own campaign, you're not taking all this money from special interest groups who are going to own you by the time you get to the White House. So this is unprecedented. You know, I have argued against political action for many years, but when I get new information, I have to adapt to it. That's called being rational. And so it is a new situation. It is a new environment. There is someone who has never before appeared in American politics, you know, somebody with the charisma, the speaking skills, the public visibility, the historical relationship with the media, the courage, the nads, you could say, to actually do what he says he's going to do. Not just make promises that his donors have told him to make so that they can pay him to break them later. This is direct, as direct a set of Democratic principles and Republican principles as we can imagine. So this is new. People need to understand this. I didn't anticipate it. I don't think anyone did, except perhaps Donald Trump many years ago. So this is new information. And I think that I am now, of course, encouraging people to get involved in politics. It really, really matters what happens over the next couple of weeks. Take time out of your busy schedule to get involved in this particular thing. It's only a couple of weeks. Nobody's drafting you to go to war for 5 years. It's just a couple of weeks, and you can do it all from the comfort of your own internet cafe or bathroom. Or if you have a server in your toilet like Hillary Clinton, I guess you could do it there as well. So get out, get involved. This is so important. This is so important. It really does come down to this. If the left gets in and there's more third world migration and there's open borders, and I mean, it's over. There's nothing left. And as far as this goes, Trump wants to work with Russia in a positive sense. And
okay, there goes Stefan Molyneux breaking up a little bit there. FreeDomainRadio.com is the website. Go and check that out. Go and check out Stefan's amazing YouTube channel as well. Stefan Molyneux, thanks for joining us. There goes Stefan. After the break, David Knight is coming up with the third hour. He's going to talk about a number of issues, including, of course, Russia. That is escalating. WikiLeaks, the latest damaging Trump revelation from the New York Times. David Knight is coming up. Go to Infowars.com for the latest breaking news. And thanks for joining me this hour. David Knight coming up. Don't go away.
Longtime personal friend of Vladimir Putin, Dmitry Kiselyov, who was appointed in 2013 to run state-run media for Putin, came out and asked the question that many Americans are asking. With Trump ahead in the polls, with Hillary floundering and clearly having a medical crisis, will the establishment, the corrupt globalists that have hijacked America, kill Donald Trump? Now, this is really important because the individual saying this is basically the mouth of Vladimir Putin. So this is Vladimir Putin telling the American people, the Russian people, and the people of the world about their concerns for Donald Trump. And I think these concerns are extremely valid. Here is the report.
Two important pieces of news regarding Donald Trump. Number one, he is ahead in polls by 2 points. Number two, Trump declared that if he is president, he aims to have, quote, very good relations with Russia. This combination of Trump's characteristics, his leadership in the presidential race, his ability to speak boldly, his intentions to turn over a new leaf regarding the Russian-American relations, all this puts Trump in a very dangerous situation. Now they can just simply kill him. The intelligence services of the United States are not interested in the type of President Trump vows to be, because the contrived enemy in the form of Russia justifies their existence. American elites are not interested in a President Trump, as the establishment world order provides them with reliable sources of lucrative business. Trump, on the other hand, who is ready to reach agreements, would bring about a different set of financial opportunities flowing in other directions. The American establishment is merciless. Call Craig Roberts, former Assistant Secretary of the Treasury for Economic Policy under President Reagan, has published a guest column on his website back in March by a journalist, Stephen Lendman, who commented on what has become a very popular theme on social media websites. Quote, maybe an unfortunate plane crash, other fatal accident, or mysterious, incurable, fast-acting, deadly illness is planned. Will Trump be gone before Republicans choose their nominee in July, or perhaps before November's election? This narrative hasn't stopped, but the current state of the presidential race for Hillary Clinton is such where she has used up all of her available ammunition against Trump. She has an empty holder. Yet there are still almost 2 months to go until the election. She has already accused Trump of being a Putin agent, that he hates Muslims, Mexicans, and blacks, and his wife Melania is unworthy of the title of the First Lady, and that Trump himself is simply unfit, and that he's even deranged, and that he understands nothing in the way of the U.S. strategy, nor international affairs. And that he's a misogynist. Meanwhile, Trump details his plan of building relations with Russia, goes to Mexico, visits a popular black church, defends his wife's honor in court, and sees to his popularity among women. And the result? The scars put on Trump have nearly closed up, but the holes inflicted on Clinton are needing emergency surgery. Her carelessness with handling classified material while Secretary of State, foreign policy that led to terrorist expansion, her avarice and the questionable reputation of foreign donors to the Clinton Foundation, the dirty tricks of the Democratic National Committee favoring one candidate over the other, and finally Hillary's failing health, whether it's her fainting episodes or the coughing fits. So what's the solution? Shoot Trump? The option isn't far-fetched. After all, the United States has boasted of more president shootings than any other country in the world.
Russia has state-run media. Here in the United States, we have global corporate-run media that literally has seized control of our nation. And just as Putin helped kick the oligarchs out of Russia, we're seeing the exact same thing begin to unfold here with Donald J. Trump leading a movement to kick the same oligarchs out of the United States. That's why they've tripled down, even in the Washington Post today, and are now claiming that Putin may be poisoning Hillary. Now, wait a minute. I thought that it was a conspiracy theory that she was even sick. But now the Russians are behind her illness. Ladies and gentlemen, we have foreigners already running our country. We already have globalists. And so they're trying to manipulate our nationalism against the Russians, hoping that we don't see the real threat internally that has hijacked our nation. I'm Alex Jones reporting for Infowars.com.
Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and you were just hearing in the last hour Stefan Molyneux talking to Paul Joseph Watson. And of course, Stefan Molyneux is not an American. He's a Canadian. Everyone is concerned, and rightfully so, about the U.S. election, especially when we look at this CNN story saying that Russia and the U.S. are moving past the Cold War to an unpredictable confrontation. Now, as you heard with the special report from Margaret Howell, talking about how Russia is ordering the children of government workers abroad to be sent back home. They've had massive civil defense drills in Russia. They know what it's like to be attacked. They went through the massive attacks of the Nazis during World War II. So that's within their living memory. Americans don't take this very seriously, but the Russians do. And when you look at CNN coming out and saying that Russia and the U.S. are moving past Cold War, we didn't have a Cold War until we had Obama and Hillary. Hillary and Obama revived the Cold War. They began acting aggressively against Russia. Victoria Nuland talked about how they'd spent billions of dollars, also working with George Soros, to create the situation in Ukraine and in the Crimea. Then we have the situation in Syria. And now they're saying this is an unpredictable confrontation that is building up here. This is going beyond the surrogates that we have there. And of course, who are our surrogates? Our surrogates are al-Nusra, al-Qaeda, and ISIS. Those are our surrogates. And we've seen this time and again. Now, out of Washington, CNN reports it's not a new Cold War. It's not even a deep chill. It's an outright conflict, they said. U.S.-Russia relations have deteriorated sharply under they're the people that they love so much, Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama. Okay, they have destroyed Libya. They're destroying Syria. They've set the Middle East on fire. They've given us a new Cold War, and they're going beyond the Cold War. This is a hot war. It is being fought with surrogates. It's also, as we're going to see here, being fought with U.S. troops and Russian troops now getting involved. And the surrogates are there as a beard, but that beard is being removed, folks. They say this is deteriorating sharply amid a barrage of accusations, disagreements, raising the stakes on issues ranging from the country's competing military operations in Syria, disputes over Eastern European independence, and escalating cyber breaches. All three of those things are inventions of the U.S. government. Okay, the military operations in Syria, invention of the U.S. government. The situation that they created in Eastern Europe with Ukraine and Crimea, an invention of the U.S. State Department and the Obama administration, Hillary's State Department. And then this whole thing about cyber breaches that they're now increasingly linking to political and economic sanctions and military strikes in retaliation for imagined cyber breaches. This is the perfect false flag. A situation where they can assert that something has happened that we can't even verify, perhaps a serious cyber breach has occurred, they can tell us. And then they can tell us they have determined that it's the Russians, and so therefore a strike is justified. And Obama even doubled down yesterday, linking this to the false claims that it's Russia that is interfering in our election. Now, the director of the Kenan Institute at the Wilson Center on the U.S.-Russia confrontations is quoted by CNN as saying, this is a conflict, there should be no doubt. They go on to say that Moscow has steadfastly denied that it is meddling in the U.S. presidential election. In an interview this week with CNN's Christiane Amanpour, Russian Foreign Minister Sergei Lavrov said it was a baseless accusation. He said it's flattering, of course, to get this kind of attention for a regional power, as President Obama called us some time ago. We have not seen a single fact, a single proof. As a matter of fact, what we see now, as we see the Office of the Director of National Security and Department of Homeland Security coming out, they say, well, we know it's the Russians because it's their motivation. They have an MO to do this, we believe. Well, why would the Russians dislike, why would the Russians dislike America so much? Well, it's because of what I just said. We have manufactured chaos. We have manufactured conflict. Again, Eastern Europe, Syria, and now they come back and manufacture a conflict with this cyber issues. You know, it's interesting. I had just today a guy that follows me on Twitter. I follow him. Come back, and he's a white hat hacker. In other words, he's a consultant to people on how to prevent hacking. So they essentially try to find vulnerabilities in systems. And then once they find it, they advise the people who have hired them how to protect against those vulnerabilities. That's called white hat hacking, as opposed to black hat hacking, where people do it surreptitiously for their own personal benefit to do harm to other people. Well, he had a tweet back in April, and he said in this tweet back in April, he said, Hack-a-pack chatter on back channels for a month now. There will be a huge dump soon. And he retweeted that today and said, it's not the Russians. Notice that I put this out months before even the DNC hacks came out. We've had William Binney, former technical head of the NSA, saying he doesn't believe it's the Russians. He believes that it's people in the NSA who are concerned about what Hillary Clinton has done to endanger the lives of people with her security breaches. And so there's a lot of people that don't believe that it's the Russians. I don't believe it's the Russians. We don't have any proof, and yet they are escalating this to the point of conflict. This is a very serious situation. We should take this very seriously. We should understand that if we have Hillary Clinton continue this policy of chaos, destruction, and perpetual war for the benefit of her bankers, and these are the people who always benefit from war, folks. Now, rich man's war, poor man's fight. That's what they said during the Civil War. It's always true. It's how the Rothschilds make their money, and it's how the rest of us die and get poor and see our countries destroyed. Now, they're trying to do this in multiple ways. It's not just the confrontation with Russia, but then, of course, Hillary Clinton, knowing 3 years ago when she talked to a Jewish group, we see now from the email, she said, hey, the situation that's going on in Syria right now, we've got all these refugees that are being created. It's a real issue for Jordan because They want to help the refugees. They want to let some of these refugees into their country. And, of course, it's contiguous to Syria. It isn't like we're flying them in like Obama and Hillary Clinton are trying to do now to America, to Europe. But they were flooding over the borders. And she said, how can you tell who are the legitimate refugees and who are jihadis? You can't vet them. Hillary Clinton said that. You can't vet them 3 years ago. But when Donald Trump says it, when Donald Trump says, hey, we've got to stop this flow of refugees and migrants in until we can figure out who these people are, he's a racist. He's a xenophobe. He's an Islamophobe. Okay, he wants to stop all Muslim immigration. Now, she said the same thing. And any rational person understands that there's absolutely no way that you can vet these people, that you know who they are. Now, today we've also seen Russia coming out and making a statement about what's going on in Mosul. And of course, Mosul, for Gary Johnson and other people who like him, Mosul is in Iraq. Okay, Aleppo is in Syria. Now, in Mosul, it is a stronghold of ISIS. And we have had a buildup going on with the Iraqi forces and, of course, with American forces as well. They have now, on at least two occasions, added another 500 troops to the area and a buildup for Mosul. And this has been going on for a very long time, telegraphing what they're going to do. If they were serious about taking out ISIS in Mosul, they would do it, wouldn't they? They would do it surreptitiously and as quickly as possible. But instead, they telegraph their intentions for a very long time. And then they come out and they say, even though we've got this massive troop buildup, we're not really going to use it. We don't really have American boots on the ground. Remember Hillary Clinton said that? She said, we're not going to have any more American boots on the ground in Iraq now or ever. And yet it's going on and there's a buildup that is happening right now for a massive battle, they say. Yet Moscow is saying this is simply a phony show. Which it certainly looks like. The U.S. is plotting to allow 9,000 ISIS fighters to escape the terror capital of Mosul, claims Moscow. They claim that the U.S. will let ISIS retreat from Mosul in safety in a secret deal with Saudi Arabia. Now, what have we seen from some of these leaked emails in the last couple of days? We have seen confirmation that Saudi Arabia and Qatar are giving aid to ISIS. They're arming ISIS. And of course, there are surrogates. The arms flow from us to Saudis, and then the Saudis give it to ISIS. Saudis are our partners throughout the Middle East. The most brutal regime. And again, in that same meeting 3 years ago, where Hillary Clinton was talking about how we couldn't vet the people coming out of Syria, we couldn't distinguish the refugees from the legitimate refugees from the jihadis. At the same time, she said, it's interesting that the most extreme ideology in the Middle East is coming out of Saudi Arabia and has so for the last 30 years. And she was saying that to a group of Jewish people. And yet that is the government that we work the most closely with and have since we created the petrodollar. You have to understand, they essentially back our fiat currency that is generated by the Federal Reserve. Once Nixon and Kissinger took us off the gold standard, we backed it with oil, with Saudi Arabia, with OPEC. Okay, they decided, they agreed that they would denominate oil sales in dollars, that they would take massive T-bills in exchange, that they would support our fiat currency. And so we have been linked at the hip with them ever since, not only economically, but also militarily throughout the region. So when Saudi Arabia is arming ISIS, and we know this from the Hillary Clinton emails, it's not a stretch to say that they are doing a secret deal to let ISIS out to go into Syria, to go into Iran. Because understand that Saudis hate these other Arab states as much as they do Israel. See, they're different. They have Sunnis, Shias, and Wahhabis, different sects of Islam. And they hate each other virulently. And they try to take each other's governments down, okay? You have theocracies throughout the region. Anyway, they say thousands of ISIS fighters are to be given safe passage out of Iraq to fight in Syria, claim Russian military leaders. Nearly 1,000 U.S. and British troops have been sent to retake Mosul, says the British paper. The largest city under ISIS control, the RAF and the U.S. Air Force, are on standby to support any ground attacks with major airstrikes. And yet, Hillary says it isn't happening. They can't keep their lies straight. Either we have people there that are fighting, or we don't, or we're going to let ISIS out and go to Syria to fight. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. We're going to talk about Project Veritas. They're doing such a great job that they got blocked on Twitter for 12 hours. That's how you know you're really getting to them, is when you get blocked, literally blocked. That's the way they respond. They don't try to argue with you. They just censor you. And so they got blocked from Twitter. We're going to talk to you about what that's about, as well as some of the amazing revelations that they've had in the last couple of days. Before we do, real quickly, we have Knockout Sleep Support at 25% off. This is a flash sale at InfoWarsLife.com. Again, you know, when you look at your lifespan, when you've got small children, have you ever noticed how small children can sleep through anything? I mean, noises, whatever, you pick them up, they fall asleep, you pick them up, you carry them to bed, they never wake up. Well, that's because of the way their body produces melatonin, and that melatonin drops off as you get older. And it continues to drop off. And so you don't sleep too soundly once you start getting into your 20s or 30s or whatever. You're not sleeping like a baby anymore. That's what the phrase comes from. And by the time you start getting older, I had a 70-year-old friend of mine send me an email talking about how he could not believe what Knockout Sleep did for him. And, of course, the other thing that you also notice is that I've used melatonin when I travel to get rid of jet lag, to essentially reset my clock. So the body naturally produces melatonin, but that drops off with age. You can also use that to reset your clock. You know, sometimes as one of these people, you can look at a lot of reviews on InfoWarsLife.com. Here's one of them, but very best sleep aid I've ever tried. He said, I often drink too much coffee and I have difficulty getting to sleep. So that's the same problem I have. And so sometimes when I do that, I'm working late at night, and I'm drinking coffee late at night here at the studio, I can't fall asleep. So I take Knockout, and that resets my clock, the same as if I was traveling. He says, I also sometimes need to go to bed late, wake up early. The stuff really helps me fall asleep fast and to get the most out of my rest period. One of my favorite benefits of this product is the increased and vivid dreams. Extraordinary product. Well, I don't know that I've necessarily had vivid dreams, but I tell you what, it gives me a very restful sleep. And again, you can get that 25% off in a flash sale at InfoWarsLife.com. So what did Project Veritas do that got the system so upset that they got blocked off of Twitter for 12 hours? And they've got the insert here that you can see where it got sent out with a Project Veritas put the article. They took a screenshot of how they got blocked from Twitter. Well, in the last couple of days, we've had nearly, I guess it's been 2 or 3 days this whole week, we've had almost daily revelations coming out of Project Veritas. First, we had the situation in Manhattan. We saw the election official on an open mic talking about how massive the voter fraud was there. He said, they're giving people phony IDs. We can't by law even check IDs. It's ridiculous, he said. And this is a guy who's the election official. This is the person talking to him, says, well, why don't you do something about it? And he goes, I can't. I don't write the laws. There's nothing I can do about it. I have to follow the laws. I see the fraud, but I can't do anything about it, he said. Then they went, I think it was to Virginia, and they talked to somebody, a couple of people, and they got them on mic talking about how it was okay if they wanted to just rip up voter registrations of people if they're registering Republican. Yeah, that's all right. Just rip up the registration and don't turn it in. Yeah, that's okay. You can do that. So Project Veritas got that. Now, the newest thing that they got was they went to a fundraiser for Russ Feingold. Now, he's a former Democrat senator from Wisconsin. He's running an attempt to win back his old Senate seat. He was at a fundraiser, and he said that Hillary Clinton might issue executive orders on gun control. The video was captured by Project Veritas. It was a $2,700 per head fundraiser held in California, okay, trying to get gun control enacted by executive order. He says if there's still Republican control in Congress, and if Hillary is elected, is there anything she can do? Asked the person. And Feingold says, well, there's executive orders. See, it doesn't matter what the Constitution says. It doesn't matter what the laws say. It also doesn't matter. One of the things that Hillary has talked about is that she's not only going to, by executive order, do background checks and other things like that. Understand that's going to be the no-fly list applied to making it a no-buy list. But also, to sue gun manufacturers. This is something that is dear to the heart of the authoritarians in the Democrat Party. Even though it is a violation of the purpose of lawsuits, these people have done absolutely nothing wrong. They made guns. Guns can be used to protect people, they can be used to defend people, or they can be used to commit crimes. And you can say that of anything that is manufactured. The Second Amendment protects it. And then as the Democrats said, we're going to shut them down with continual lawsuits, Congress enacted a law and said, no, you're not going to be able to sue them unless they did something that was negligent, unless they did something that was criminal. That is a basic principle of our law, of our legal system. And yet, you see, throughout the Democrat campaign, Hillary demanding that that happen, and now she's saying she's going to do it by executive order. You show that, you get your Twitter account shut down. Stay back. Stay with us. We'll be right back. We're going to talk about how the RNC spent $0 to help Trump. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. You know, there was an amazing article that I saw on Politico. This headline just stunned me. The Republican National Committee, TV ad spending for Donald Trump, $0. Not a single cent. You want to talk about somebody being an outsider? You want to talk about somebody that is hated by the establishment of both mainstream parties that have manipulated this system for so long? The phony GOP rhinos, run by Paul Ryan himself, promising that they're going to shut down Obamacare. They never were going to shut down Obamacare. Look, going back 4 years ago to the election, Mitt Romney, you were going to get Obamacare whether it was Obama or whether it was Romney care. I mean, Romney had exactly the same system that he had put together with the Democrats, with Ted Kennedy, as governor of Massachusetts. They were going to turn over our insurance to their crony capitalist friends in the insurance business, and they were going to hold a gun to our head with the IRS and force us to buy it at an inflated price, regardless of whether it was Republicans or Democrats. And then they come back 2 years later and say, vote for Republicans so we can get rid of Obamacare. That's how phony it is. And it's phony on the borders. It's phony on all these different issues. And this is the true phoniness of this. This is shows you how Donald Trump is the outsider that both Republicans and the Democrats want to take down. And we saw this Friday with that release of that tape coming from one of the Bush family members, putting that out to save Hillary's bacon when all of these WikiLeaks documents started coming out. But take a look at this from Politico. They point out the Republican National Committee insists that it's doing everything in its power to elect Donald Trump. And you know, we keep having every time they put out their dirt on Hillary Clinton, the Republicans and the Democrats dump dirt on Donald Trump. Whenever they do that, you've always got all these Republicans going, well, that's it. Now I can't support Donald Trump. You never supported Donald Trump. Lindsey Graham, Paul Ryan, Mitch McConnell, you guys never supported him. You've got the same agenda as the Democrats. Anyway, but as Trump gets clobbered, they say, on the TV airwaves by his well-funded Democrat rival, the RNC has been conspicuously absent. A Politico analysis of campaign finance records reveals that the committee has not spent anything, on commercials boosting Trump since he emerged as the party's likely nominee. Okay? So much for all this hand-wringing from these Republicans. Oh, gee, I really wanted it, but now I can't support him anymore, right? In 2008, 2012, the RNC spent tens of millions of dollars on so-called independent expenditures, principally TV ads, but also direct mail and phone banks supporting its nominees or attacking their Democrat rivals. Here's an example, okay? And this is a former RNC political director says the Democrats have an unprecedented lopsided advertising advantage in this race like we have never seen before, and it is having serious and negative effects. And he goes on to say, it is a terrible mistake, whether you believe that Trump can win or not. He says it's a terrible mistake for the RNC to set this out to spend $0 for Donald Trump. He says it's a terrible mistake not to have $50 million of advertising from a Republican Party exposing Hillary Clinton and keeping her numbers down. Now, what did they do in 2008 with John McCain running against Obama? Well, they spent $53.5 million supporting John McCain against Barack Obama. In 2012, the RNC spent $42.4 million helping Mitt Romney against President Obama, okay? And 80% of that spending happened before mid-October, before now. And, of course, they have spent $0 in this cycle. All they have spent in this entire election cycle was $321,000. Not $50 million, but one-third of a million. And they did that attacking Hillary Clinton before Trump emerged as the leader of the GOP PAC. So once they saw that an outsider and an outsider movement was taking over their phony opposition party, they cut off all spending. They had spent one-third of a million attacking Hillary, and then they cut it off completely when it looked like it was going to be Donald Trump. And they spent $50 million on the previous two elections, but not a cent for Donald Trump. You want to talk about all these people that say, oh, I can't vote for a Republican, and people like Jesse Ventura. I understand Jesse Ventura is in Mexico. He's not really keeping up with American politics. He thinks he's got an outsider with Gary Johnson. He's the ultimate insider, okay, he and Governor Weld. And then he's got a true outsider who's taken over the party. And here's another example of this is how it's not only Donald Trump, but it's the movement that is taking over the party. Look at the story out of Pennsylvania, Pittsburgh, CBS affiliate. Nearly 100,000 Pennsylvania voters switched from Democrat to Republican. 100,000 switched from Democrat to Republican. See, they understand the situation that's going on. They understand how they've been betrayed by the Democrat Party. These are workers who used to have factories and mines that they worked in, and these have been shut down by the Democrats that decide that they're going to reorder the economy to suit their globalist multinational corporate bosses and to suit their other agendas, okay? And think about this as a metric. We're constantly seeing all of these phony polls, and I say that they are phony. You got to understand that these political pollsters are nothing but court jesters for the political establishment. They're clowns telling you whatever the political establishment wants you to hear. They're nothing but court jesters. When they say they've got a poll with a mean error of 4 points, plus or minus 4 points, okay? And then they're 10 points apart from each other. It's like, that doesn't add up, right? Doesn't add up. And you can look at their assumptions, whether it is a skewing it towards 15% more Democrats than Republicans, which is not the way the voter registration is set up, or whether they're even looking at something like likely voters. That doesn't apply in this election, because we've got a lot of people who have never voted in their life before or haven't voted for decades that are now seeing that there is a real difference. You heard Stefan Molyneux in the last hour talking to Paul Joseph Watson. He said, I've advised people not even to pay any attention to politics. Just get out of it. It's not worth it. But he said, this time we have a difference. This time we have somebody who is outside. This time we have somebody who will fight the globalist consolidation, who will fight the governance by corporations, who will call it for what it is. Speak out plainly about what is going on and tell the truth about the global consolidation that is going on. Rule by corporations. That's what Donald Trump said. And of course, he was merely repeating what Hillary Clinton had told her banker friends in one of her expensive speeches that she was giving, saying, you know, hey, we're going to have hemispheric common market. We're going to have open borders. We're going to have open trade, all of that. North American Union, open borders, and saying, this is the North American Union that she's talking about. The thing that they keep telling us doesn't exist. And yet we see it in her emails. And then also talking about a green, sustainable economy, reorganizing the entire world economy based on this myth of climate change, man-made climate change, doing that so that they can create a global imperative for world government and fund it with a global carbon tax. But let's take a look at this Pennsylvania situation. 100,000 Pennsylvanian voters switched from Democrat to Republican. This is a much better metric than any of these phony polls that they're giving you. They say, what's more, the Pennsylvania Republican Party says that more than 240,000 new voters have joined the party since last November. 240,000. 100,000 of those switching from Democrat to Republican. And yet, we're told by the mainstream media, Donald Trump doesn't have a chance in Pennsylvania. He doesn't have a chance, they say. Say, nearly twice the number of newly registered Republicans compared to both 2008 and 2012 numbers combined. And yet, the RNC will not spend a penny to help Donald Trump, because they don't want their party taken over by outsiders. They don't want a party that is going to put America first. They want a party that is going to put globalism first. That's what they have been working on with the Democrats. Now, the good news that we see from the Rasmussen poll, and again, it's another poll, okay, and you can take it with a grain of salt. Nevertheless, they say the full results from Sunday night's debate are in, and Rasmussen says that Donald Trump is now taking the lead back. They say the latest poll shows Trump with 43% and Hillary Clinton with 41%. They say yesterday, Clinton still held a four-point lead, 43% to 39% over Trump, and that was down from 5 points on Tuesday, her biggest lead ever of 7 points on Monday. So they dump all this dirt with the help of the Bush family on Friday. On Monday, they do their polls on a day-to-day basis during the week. So they dump all the dirt on Friday. They do the poll on Monday, 7 points ahead for Hillary. The next day, she's 5 points ahead. The next day, she's 4 points ahead. Today, Trump is 2 points ahead. You see that? See the trend? You see a trend? Whether it's true or not, and of course, they're looking at likely voters. And again, I think that even underrepresents Donald Trump's position there. Now, as he was campaigning yesterday in Florida, another battleground state, he was in Lakeland, Florida, and in Ocala, Florida. And he was telling people, we've got to jail Hillary. Hillary for prison. And he needs to be talking about that. We all need to get Hillary, if not in jail, we need to make sure she's not in the White House. But I'd like to see her in the big house. He said after getting the subpoena to give over her emails and lots of other things, she deleted the emails. And, of course, she destroyed the server. She destroyed the devices, the multiple devices that she had, even though she lied and said she had single devices. He said she has to go to jail. And they say there were rousing cheers based on her crimes. She should not be allowed to run for president. It's time for a new direction, he said, to chants of lock her up from the crowd. Then he goes to Ocala and he says this, whether I win, lose, or draw, I'm ashamed of what's happened to our country, and so are you. You know what? So are the FBI and the Department of Justice employees. They're ashamed of what's happened to our country as well. Look at this article here from Fox News. The FBI and the Department of Justice are roiled by the Comey Lynch decision to let Clinton slide on the emails, says an insider. Now, this is one person, they say, closely involved in the years-long probe that told Fox News that career agents and attorneys on the case unanimously believed the Democrat presidential nominee should have been charged. The source who spoke to Fox News on the condition of anonymity said that FBI Director James Comey's dramatic July 5th announcement that he would not recommend to the Attorney General's office that the former Secretary of State be charged left members of the investigative team dismayed and disgusted. Dismayed and disgusted. More than 100 FBI agents and analysts worked around the clock with six attorneys from the Department of Justice National Security Division, counter-espionage section, to investigate the case. And the source whose identity and role in the case has been verified by Fox News, they say, said no trial-level attorney agreed, no agent working the case agreed with the decision not to prosecute. It was a top-down decision. And they say a high-ranking FBI official told Fox News that while it might not have been a unanimous decision, it was unanimous that we all wanted her security clearance yanked, and that's what they did to the former CIA director under Bill Clinton. He had to give him a pardon to keep him from going to jail because he had a couple of documents were found on his laptop. Not the kind of massive abuse, calculated, premeditated abuse that we saw with Hillary Clinton. A couple of documents that were on his laptop. The CIA director at the time was facing jail time over it. Anyone other than the Clintons would be in jail now, not running for president of the United States. What a travesty this is. And the FBI and Department of Justice agents know this. These people have worked on this for years, and they've seen their work flushed down the toilet by a friend of Hillary Clinton. And you have to understand, that's precisely what James Comey is. James Comey is a Clinton crony. Crony Comey. Tongue twister, but we could say that. That's definitely true. They go on to say, it's safe to say the vast majority felt that she should be prosecuted, said the senior FBI official to Fox News. We were floored while listening to the FBI briefing because Comey laid it all out. And then he said, but we're doing nothing, which made no sense to us. You know what? It didn't make any sense to me either. I can only imagine what these people felt because they knew even more than I did. And I was sitting there watching this on the 4th of July weekend with my wife. And I'm listening to this, and I said, he's going to indict her. I never thought somebody that was that closely tied to Hillary Clinton would indict her, but he's admitting that she's committed massive felony violations. And then he says, but we're not going to do anything. We're not going to do anything. But don't you try this at home, he said. Because if anybody else thinks that they're going to get away with this, they're not going to get away with this. And they've now seen that other people, for very innocuous things, one guy, he took some photographs inside a submarine, and he took them as souvenirs for his kids. And he said, yeah, I kind of knew that was wrong. And you know what? That was something that would have been the lowest level of classification, confidential. But he's in big trouble, and the Hillary defense doesn't work for him because, you know, here's the deal. We talk about Comey being a Hillary crony. So is Loretta Lynch. You understand, the two of them let off Sandy Berger for doing the exact same thing that Hillary Clinton is doing, but in a smaller scale, in a physical manner. So here she's doing this stuff on an email server, on her network of private servers, her network of devices. And if you remember, going back to the investigation into 9/11, they wanted to know what the Clinton administration knew about Islamic terrorists leading up to 9/11. And so they wanted to get some information. So Sandy Berger, who had been with the administration on security issues, goes to the National Security Archives. He takes out a bunch of documents, and the people at the National Security Archives have his poster up. He is a poster child for how not to do this. Do not give individuals special privileges, they say. We made a mistake, they all say. We let him get away with it because he was Sandy Berger. So they let him take out documents. They let him say, well, I've got to go to the bathroom and take these documents with me. Don't come with it. They saw him stuffing these things into his clothes, into his pants. He admitted that he destroyed these documents so that he could cover for anything that might have incriminated the Clinton administration. And then he walked. How did he walk? The people who were in charge of looking at Sandy Berger were the same people who just gave Hillary Clinton a pass for destroying evidence, obstructing justice, committing felonies. It was James Comey and Loretta Lynch. They were the ones in charge of the non-prosecution of Sandy Berger. And of course, they were part of a law firm. They were partners in a law firm that used to do the Clintons' taxes. And you remember HSBC, the bank that's been convicted multiple times, or, you know, convicted, but nothing's happened to them, of course. Convicted multiple times of money laundering for drug cartels, for terrorist organizations. The Sinaloa drug cartel even had their own private checkout window at HSBC. Multiple times they've been convicted, but nothing happens to them. They're too big to jail. It was Loretta Lynch that let them go. And it was James Comey who was on the board of that money laundering bank. And now they sat there in Washington covering for Hillary Clinton, flushing it down the toilet. And it doesn't make any difference. And all these hundreds of FBI agents who look at all this stuff, they understand it, and they know that it's a top-down decision to let her walk. Now, when we come back, we're going to take a look at the other videos that are coming out in terms of the latest accusations. And, you know, we have this woman who comes out and says, you know, 35 years ago, I was on a public plane with Donald Trump, and he was just all over me like an octopus. Nobody saw it. She didn't tell anybody for 35 years, but she's on a public plane and nobody saw this. But he was on her like an octopus. Maybe we should call her Octopussy. I don't know. We'll look at the Octopussy investigation when we come back. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. Yeah, we're going to talk a little bit more about the new allegations that have surfaced. But we're also going to talk about the new emails that have surfaced. We've now had six revelations, unless there's been some more since I got on the air. I mean, they're coming very quickly out of WikiLeaks right now, and it is difficult for the media to even keep up with the volume of stuff that is coming out here. But a lot of amazing things are coming out. Before we get back to the news, I just want to remind you that we have a flash sale on Knockout Sleep Support. It's 25% off at InfoWarsLife.com. As I pointed out, it's a great way to reset your clock if you're traveling and got jet lag. It's a great way to reset your clock if you've been drinking coffee late at night, or if you're just getting older and the natural production of melatonin is dropping down. It has melatonin in it, but it's got so many other natural ingredients like valerian root extract, chamomile flower extract, L-tryptophan. That's the chemical that's in turkey, naturally, that makes you sleepy after you have your Thanksgiving meals. Right now, you can get that at 25% off at InfoWarsLife.com for a very limited time. It's a flash sale going on there. Now, as we see, as I point out, you know, the phoniness of and the desperation. We've got the New York Times out there, as well as the Washington Post, bragging about how they've got an army of reporters going out to try to dig up dirt on Donald Trump. And, you know, quite frankly, I think they're willing to make up anything that they can't find. So now we've got this lady who says she was next to Donald Trump on an airplane, a public airplane, and he started touching her inappropriately and it got carried away. She said, oh, I wouldn't have minded so much if it was up top. And it's like, what? What? How is that consistent with any of this? But then he started going down low. Yet nobody on the airplane saw it. The stewardesses didn't see it. The passengers around there didn't see it. She didn't say anything to anybody for 35 years. But then she waits until just before the presidential election and comes out with the New York Times, the people who have devoted themselves to taking down Donald Trump, the people that we see through the emails have declared their undying love and devotion to Hillary Clinton, who have coordinated with Hillary Clinton, as we see these people who are sending her the exact questions that are going to be given on town halls, coordinating with her in the background. It's just absolutely amazing. And so now we have this woman who says she's grabbing him like an octopus. I said, well, we need to call this the octopusy exposition here. You know, it's absolutely ridiculous. It's a cartoon character assassination is what it truly is. But I want to take a look at some of the other stuff that's been released, because that's what they don't want you to see. They don't want you to see what WikiLeaks is putting out. And here's a story from Washington Times saying, long before Hillary Clinton called Americans a basket of deplorables, and she said, you know, half of Donald Trump's supporters, no, I take that back. That was too conservative. And then all of her supporters in the media said, no, it's all of them. They're all deplorables. Her top campaign advisors, her liberal allies, all these people who are saying that Juanita Broderick is disgusting. Oh, by the way, let's play that video. We got Juanita Broderick talking about these rape protesters, because we just had somebody get beat up in Las Vegas by some thugs wearing union T-shirts there at a rally, saying that Bill Clinton is a rapist. Let's play that video clip of Juanita Broderick.
Nobody can dispute the fact
that you're a rapist.
That we need.
Bill Clinton is a rapist.
Nobody can dispute the fact that you're a rapist.
Thank you.
Well, I hope that no one gets hurt during this, but I hope it encourages people to say, why are they saying this? What does Bill Clinton have to do with rape? And then hopefully they'll research and find out.
Yeah, but maybe we have had somebody that got hurt in the Vegas rally, as I point out. But let's take a look at these revelations coming out of WikiLeaks. You know, when I look at this, I'm reminded of Mark Twain's that a pen warmed up in hell. You know, Hillary is not only spiteful, but she's a hateful bigot. They went after openly mocked Catholics, Southerners, a host of other groups, including Hispanics, okay? They talked about Bernie Sanders supporters as being self-righteous whiners. We're going to talk more about this right after the break. Fourth hour, Rob Dew is going to be with us. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. In the next segment, we're going to be joined by Rob Dew. Just wanted to finish up on these email revelations and then talk to you about how they're going to ban transportation as you know it. That's coming down the pike very, very quickly. But these latest revelations, as I pointed out, you know, it's truly amazing. Yeah, when I see these revelations coming out as well about Danny Williams, the guy who says and makes a pretty good case that he's the illegitimate son of Bill Clinton, and he says, Hillary, please stop blocking me from seeing my dad, Bill Clinton. And I look at it and it's like, you know, what would it be like to have a wicked stepmother like Hillary Clinton? I mean, she is like the quintessential wicked stepmother. I just want to say he seemed like a really nice guy. He was here yesterday in studio. He seems like a very nice man. And I just want to give him a piece of advice and say, stay as far away from the Clintons as you can, especially Hillary Clinton. I mean, she don't take any shiny red apples from her either if you get around her. But look at the venom coming out of the Hillary Clinton campaign against supporters of Sanders, calling them self-righteous whiners, calling Hispanic leaders needy Latinos, calling CNN anchor Jake Tapper a dick, okay, going on and on and on, and then throwing the Catholics under the bus to the extent that the Catholics are coming out and saying, hey, we need to have the campaign spokeswoman, Jennifer Palmieri, to resign. If you really don't want to, are you going to distance yourself from her comments? Remember when they said that to Donald Trump about this Ku Klux Klan guy who says, oh, I like Donald Trump, and it's like, he didn't invite that. As a matter of fact, when he was looking at the Reform Party, he said, well, I'm not going to get into that because we've got people from the Klan getting into that at this point in time. So he had said back in, I think it was 2000, he said, I'm not going to get involved in that. And yet somebody endorses him, and then you just hear this constant drumbeat. Are you going to disavow? Is she going to disavow the hatred from her campaign staff mocking Catholics? You know, of course, they're not mocking. When you look at what they're saying, the types of things that they're saying, what would happen if they were saying that kind of thing about the religion that they revere, Islam, in the Clinton campaign? We're also seeing more revelations within these emails about how Cheryl Mills, remember, she got immunity before she would even agree to turn over laptop. I mean, they treat her with more deference than they did the former CIA director. They didn't ask him if they could have his laptop. They just took it. And then Bill Clinton had to give him a pardon, but they still revoked his security clearance. But Cheryl Mills and these other staffers, you got to give me immunity before I give you my laptop. You're just the FBI. I'm with Hillary Clinton. Okay, but now we see these emails pointing out the obvious conflict of interest of how she's working for the State Department and the Clinton Foundation at the same time, because that's the way they laundered their money. These people know how to launder money. Okay. Goes way back. They've had decades of practice doing this. Another email. Can we survive not answering questions from the press? Yes, we can. And we can do it for 80% of the campaign, not even having a phony, prearranged press conference where she gets all the questions in advance. I mean, one of these issues, as a matter of fact, I retweeted it on my Twitter account. You can see it. You can see the email where they sent her the questions that were going to be asked by Chris Hayes at MSNBC. And then you see her scripted response. And then he does a phone interview with her, and they're pretending that she's just responding off the cuff. She had focus tested this response and had a script that she was reading off of. And you can read on the WikiLeaks email along with her as you hear her on this live, quote unquote, live interview with MSNBC. What a bunch of phony crap we're getting from the mainstream media and from the Clintons. Now, I want to shift gears real quickly here and talk about transportation. You know, there's this article today talking about, hey, there's 40,000, well, we don't have time, 40,000 bouts of tech rage over their lifetime. They say 40,800 technology malfunctions in a lifetime. You know, you see your system crash, you see these updates fail. How's that going to be like when you've got automated software? But it gets far worse than that, folks. They're going to ban diesel engines in the United States. They're going to ban internal combustion engines. Diesel engines banned next year. Internal combustion engines banned in Europe.
Well, mainstream media is having a total freak out from the words of Alex Jones once again. And this happened on Monday. Alex Jones talked about Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama, called them demons. And that from reports he's been given, that they stink and smell like sulfur. And so Media Matters picked that up, put a little thing out. Obama talks about it 2 days later. We got a little video about that coming up. My wife even sent me a link to it on some night talk show. I don't even know who the host is. I don't even know who hosts these things anymore. I forget the name of the guy. I'll pull that up in a little bit. But he even mentions it. And then we have today, just a few hours ago, this is from the New York Times. He calls Hillary Clinton a demon. Who is Alex Jones? That's what Liam Stack wants to say. And they got the video there of Obama saying, hey, literally, by the way, and he sniffs himself. It smelled like sulfur. And it's just really funny the way these people can't stand any type of criticism. Because what they are doing, just through looking at the WikiLeaks emails, which proves that they are acting in a demonic fashion, that what they're doing is not of this world. Because if you claim to be the leader or want to be the leader of your country, why would you then support the group that we're supposedly fighting? What she's admitted years ago, that we did that with Al-Qaeda. And then now it's coming out through all the WikiLeaks emails that, of course, which we've said before, she's supporting ISIS. And Obama's supporting ISIS. They got the weapons drops. They don't know where the weapons are going. Oh, we dropped them and they got them. Oh, wow, look at that. Made in the USA. They got the missiles from the secret CIA base in Libya, which was part of the whole Benghazi deal. And it just goes on and on and on. So I want to read a little bit of this New York Times article. Alex Jones is going to have a video rebuttal coming out very soon. So it starts off, President Obama took a moment at the rally this week to sniff his hand and prove that he's not really a demon from hell who reeks of sulfur and walks the earth swarmed by flies. Yet he is swarmed by flies, and we have plenty of photos to prove that. Why would the president do such a thing even in jest? Because he is scared. S-H-I, I'm not going to say it, Liss. He lifted his hand and did that, and then they go, Who is this man, Alex Jones? Where does he work? He's based in Texas, where he hosts the nationally syndicated Alex Jones Show. He's been called the most prolific conspiracy theorist in contemporary America by the Southern Poverty Law Center. Yeah, those is a great bunch of people. And then they say he's had several bursts into mainstream attention. In 2011, he aired an interview with Charlie Sheen. And then he started the petition to deport Piers Morgan. And then went on and gave Piers Morgan the highest ratings of his week ever by going on to that show and really handing it to Piers. And then by the end of the year, Piers' show was gone because he was such a popular guy. Alex actually breathed life into that show. And he just, what does he believe? He describes himself as a libertarian. Many of his views mix traditional conservative critiques of government with wild-eyed delusions about globe-spanning conspiracies. He argues that September 11th terrorist attacks and the Oklahoma City bombings were inside jobs. And all you have to do is go through just a couple of Alex's movies. 9-11, The Road to Tyranny has a great section. As powerful as the 9-11 information is in that film, there's a whole section on the Oklahoma City bombing, which shows actual local news footage of them keeping the rescuers from going into the building to look for survivors. And they say because they found a second and third bomb. And these bombs were bigger than the first bomb that went off. And that whole day, they're talking about the bomb being inside the building. Being inside the building. The governor gets on, talks about, yeah, we're removing the second and third bomb. They show the car moving up, the bomb disposal truck moving in, and then leaving. And everybody's talking about this second and third bomb that they removed that were bigger than the first. And there's witnesses talking about two explosions. Because if you have a building right here and you have a car bomb that blows up this way, explosions go out, you're not going to have material from this building fly over the explosion over to this area, which you had buildings across the street from the Murrah building had particles embedded into them. And that doesn't happen with normal Newtonian physics. When an explosion happens, it doesn't hit the building and then shoots particles over there to embed in the building. No, that only happens if you have a bomb inside the building. Alex had bomb experts on who looked at it and said, no, it looks like here you can see there's damage in different areas. And this, the worst damage is inside the building or not even where the supposed car bomb was. And then there's this big crater that never really exists that they showed a diagram of in Newsweek. Because when they can't prove anything with a photo, they show a diagram that some artist makes and go, look, here's the crater. Big giant crater. And at first it was a car bomb, and then it became a truck bomb. And then there's the footage that the FBI confiscated from all the security cameras all around the Murrah building, which showed two people getting out of that Ryder truck, the John Doe number two, the mysterious guy that suddenly doesn't exist anymore. And then you got 9-11. You got the guys, the hijackers coming in through Canada, which Mr. Springman, he worked at the embassy in Riyadh, talked about how they were given these visas to these guys, and he's saying, no, don't give them to them. These guys are bad news. They didn't listen to him. They wanted these guys in here. You've got them getting flight training in Florida at an Air Force base. You've got them being followed by FBI informants. All this stuff surrounding 9-11. There's weirdness around 9-11 everywhere. And yet, if you say it was an inside job that people in the government knew, like Dick Cheney, who's in the bunker, saying the orders still stand not to shoot down the plane. There's plenty of information out there. Plenty of information. And then Sandy Hook, basically, there's a media blackout. You can't get any information out of these public officials. Information they're supposed to provide. So, and there's plenty of information out there on that. So, if you bring up those events, oh, you're a conspiracy theorist. And it says here, in 2013, Jones argued same-sex marriage was eugenicist globalist plot to encourage the breakdown of the family. We get rid of God so the state can reign supreme. And not because they're atheists, but because they want the state to be God. And that is true. The state does want to be your God. The state wants you to pray to Chavez so you get the milk. Okay? The state wants you to depend on them. They want you to depend on them for everything. For the health care. For defense. They want you to have guns. And on and on and on. It goes on. Has Hillary Clinton justice claims? Yes, she has. She basically called him the National Enquirer and then talked about her dark heart. Yet she is someone funded by the Saudi Arabian government. And other Middle Eastern countries like Qatar. And they gave her husband $1 million. It came out. This is just in the WikiLeaks documents. She gets over 20% of her donations come from Saudi Arabia, a country that treats women like second-class citizens. But that's okay, because when you listen to liberal media out there, these insane people that go, well, she's got a lot of experience. Well, we need experience. She's got experience. Yeah, she's got experience in deceiving people, setting up fake email servers, creating rogue armed groups to take over countries where there's been power vacuums, for destroying the country of Libya, for now helping destroy, starting off the war in Syria. Yeah, she's been there the entire time. And she wants you to think she's out there fighting for you, the little guy. And she's got some of these people duped into believing that she cares about you. She doesn't care about you at all. Hillary Clinton cares about one person, and that's herself. She doesn't care about her family, I don't think. But I'm going to get into these WikiLeaks documents coming up. But first, let's just go to the video in question where Alex is talking about it. We even got Bill saying she works like a demon. But Alex Jones says that it's the end of the world. He goes on Charlie Rose and says she's been working like a demon. That's okay. It's okay for him to say it. Because I guess if when another demon says you're working like a demon, it's okay. And these people are definitely, their brains are out of this world. I don't know where they're really from, but here's the video.
I mean, she is an abject, psychopathic demon from hell that as soon as she gets into power is going to try to destroy the planet.
She's worked like a demon, as you know, as Secretary of State. And
we came, we saw, he died.
What difference at this point does it make?
And there's only one candidate in this race who understands that democracy in a big, diverse country doesn't work if you constantly demonize each other. Demonize each other.
You could put half of Trump's supporters into what I call the basket of deplorables.
And I mean that literally, by the way. I was reading the other day, there's a guy on the radio who apparently Trump's on his show frequently. He said, me and Hillary are demons.
I'm telling you. She is a demon. This is biblical. She's going to launch a nuclear war.
Said we smell like sulfur. Ain't that something? Now,
full videos up on Infowars.com. Obama responds to Alex Jones calling him and Hillary demons. I'm going to be taking your phone calls coming up. 800-259-9231. There really is tons of information coming out of WikiLeaks right now. And it's all being distracted. It's all being overshadowed by Donald Trump supposedly groping women. Of course, these women didn't say anything at the time. In fact, on that New York Times article that talks about Alex Jones, after it plays the Obama video, it goes into this other video automatically about this lady who was on a flight with Donald Trump, and he started groping her like an octopus, which is just... somebody posted on Twitter that there's another, the like an octopus analogy is what was talked about in this other source for somebody else groping women. That was also, so it's like they're taking from this other event that happened in England and putting it on Trump. And what's funny is, who is it? Who was it? Okay. And, all right. Now, we'll just save it. They were talking to me about throwing to a clip. I got into talking about something. I want to finish this point. I am going to play a John Bowne video that gets into the Mark of the Beast and how they're promoting it. But I'm also going to take your calls coming up in the next segment. 800-259-9231. 800-259-9231. We have Uncle Sam, Tom, Bruce, Matt, and Gemma already on the lines now. I'm going to take your calls. I'd really like to know what your opinion is on WikiLeaks And what do you think the biggest leak is? Because these are all being overshadowed by supposedly Donald Trump making inappropriate comments and groping women. Of course, none of these women came forward at the time. And what's interesting in that video on the New York Times website, when the lady starts talking about how the encounter was going down, it cuts to a B-roll shot of her eyes where she's not talking. It's just a close-up of her eyes. And they do that so you can't look at her body language while she's talking about the incident, because that's when people lie. They start touching themselves and looking in different areas. They don't want you to see that. They don't want people to start picking that apart. So they cover it. Because that's what these people are best at. And Trump's filing a lawsuit right now, it looks like. He's getting ready to file a lawsuit against the New York Times. So we'll see. And of course, it'll probably end at some point. They'll say, oh, no, we're just going to drop it. We're not going to post it. And it'll go that way. Let's go ahead and take calls while we're still here. Let's go to Matt in Idaho. Hillary and the Donald. What do you want to talk about, Matt? Go ahead.
Well, everybody knows that Hillary's a demon. And even my most liberal friends will not admittedly say they support Hillary. And I'm talking like these hardcore liberals. I just read The Art of the Deal, and everybody needs to read that book because it gets to the heart and core of who Donald Trump is. He used to pick up aluminum cans and turn them in for money. He states in there that he would not take women back to his apartment because he just wasn't into that. He states in there that, you know, everybody in New York seemed to be heavy drinkers, and that would give him a huge advantage. So I think that Donald needs to focus on the issues. And I mean, the Hillary attacks are red meat for everybody. We love them, but I don't think it's getting them anywhere.
Yeah, I think he should just go back to the issues. I think he came out and attacked her in this next debate, which is going to be Wednesday, which, of course, will be carrying the live feed. And so join us for that. The last one was very eventful. And I'm hoping he just goes into policy. I liked what he said in the last debate about taxes. He's like, look, she's going to raise your taxes, folks. I'm going to give you tax breaks. And people have analyzed it. $4,000 a year if you're making between, I think, $50,000 or $60,000 and $120,000. Maybe it's a little more. Maybe it's like $80,000 to $120,000. And those paying under $25,000 aren't going to pay any taxes at all. You're going to get all that money back. And you're going to see corporations getting a tax break, and they're going to hire more people, and they're going to pay you more. So people don't realize, oh, he's going to give the corporations a tax break. Well, you know, we've created this environment where corporations are gods, and you go into your schools and you learn how to become a corporate cog. So that's the system we created. We've pretty much tried to kill small businesses because small businesses are nimble and can really compete against corporations because it takes a long time for a giant corporate juggernaut to turn their ship. When a small company, especially one like us, we're very small, we can turn on a dime when something happens, and large corporations can't do that. So the system inherently doesn't like competition. But if you give these people a little bit, you're going to get more in return. And that's the system we have now. And I don't believe in giving somebody something for nothing because everybody's got to pull their weight. Thanks for calling, Matt. Let's go to Tom in Nevada. Go ahead, Tom.
Hi there. Yes, Rob, I just sent you an email, actually, with an article attachment from the Society of Professional Journalists, and it's written by a lawyer named Ty Clevenger, and he goes into some pretty exciting detail about how he filed a FOIA request for the paternity test on William Jefferson Clinton.
Yeah, and it probably doesn't exist. Hey, Tom, hold that. I'm going to let you finish up after the break. We'll be taking more of your calls, and I got more to go over on these WikiLeaks, so stay tuned. It's the Alex Jones Show. This is the fourth hour of Overdrive, and I'm your host, Rob Dew. Infowars.com is the website, and Infowars.com/show is where you can watch live. This is Rob Dew with the Alex Jones Show. And once again, you can watch us live. If you're listening to us on the radio and you want to watch video, show you all the links and all the articles here. Infowars.com/show. Infowars.com/show will get you the live free feed of the Alex Jones Show, and then it refeeds after that. You can watch a repeat and just keep it going. Please support your local radio and TV stations that are carrying this. Call them up, thank them, support their advertisers, advertise on their shows, on their stations. And don't forget to come and visit InfoWarsLife.com and InfoWarsStore.com. We got Biome Defense, which is a great probiotic if you're into probiotics, which you should be if you want to have a healthy gut. Experts agree the gut plays a huge role in normal function of your immune system. And there's also a lot of neurons in your gut. They say the gut is your second brain. So if you want to support that, get your Biome Defense. And it's got billions of 50 billion live and active cultures for 23 different probiotic strains. They say there's more gut flora in your body than there are stars in the universe. I don't know how that is. Is it supposed to be infinite? But that's what they say. And also, InfoWars Solar Base Station is 33% off retail. So check that out. One unit provides 1,500 watts of continuous power and 3,000 watts of peak power. And then it's all recharged by the power of the sun, which is why you don't see big efforts to get people to put solar. I mean, they have some of these government rebates and stuff, but you don't see it promoted very much of having solar on your home, because then you wouldn't have to have power from the power companies, and they like their monopolies on that. They want giant solar farms, giant wind farms providing power. So you're not going to see that. Also, Knockout is, what was Knockout, 25% off? I tell you, Knockout is great for if 25% off Knockout. When you, I go to Bilderberg the last 2 years. First year I went, we didn't have Knockout. Second year I brought some Knockout with me, and I took that on the plane, went out immediately. Didn't waste my time watching those in-flight movies, just slept. So when I got on the ground, I could just go right to work. And so let me tell you, Knockout works. Helps put you to sleep when you need it the most. But be sure you you need about 8 hours of sleep. Be sure you carve out that much time. You can't get up after a power nap after taking Knockout. You're going to feel really groggy. All right, Tom in Nevada, I want to finish up with you talking about the FOIA request. Who was the lawyer that wanted to put that out?
Yeah, just type, don't expect the feds to enforce FOIA, and it's by Ty Clevenger, and you better hurry, because I'm sure they'll strip it when they hear this, mm-hmm. because it explains in the most disturbing detail how the government just literally ignores FOIA. And, of course, you know Obama was to be the most transparent president ever. And I filed FOIA requests with the oversight agency that's supposed to enforce FOIA, and they've never, ever responded.
Sure. Or they'll give it to you heavily redacted.
Yes.
Judicial Watch runs into this all the time. But there was a, I think last year it came out, Judicial Watch, they knew 10 days before that attack on Benghazi that it was going to happen. 10 days before. And then Hillary gets up there and lies to the American people and said it was a video that caused these guys to go freak out. Total liar. Total liar.
Here, a thought experiment. You know, Hillary keeps saying that the Russians are hacking her, right? Now, I don't know if this
Russians do everything. Russians make the sun come up.
But let's do a quick thought experiment, if you'll bear with me. Let's take her at her word. Let's say she really knows something we don't. Well, then isn't that classified information? In other words, either she knows something she shouldn't be sharing in public, or she's lying, right?
She's lying. She's lying. They're grasping at straws. Anytime you ask them about any of these WikiLeaks emails, they go, well, it was done by the Russians and they faked it all. You really think they got somebody going in there retyping emails and changing emails up? Because you look at the language of some of these emails, it's written by neurotic weirdos. And you look at the language. And I don't agree with it. But anyway, thanks for calling, Tom. Let's go to Uncle Sam in Louisiana, my home state. Trump and the women who groped him versus WikiLeaks. Go ahead, Uncle Sam.
Hello, Rob. Say hi to David for me. It was nice to meet him over the Labor Day weekend and his wife.
Are you in New Orleans? You the guy that runs the pirate radio station off your bike?
Yeah, you got it.
Yeah. All right, go ahead.
And, I met David. He was here, and, of course, I kicked the story on me. I'm just hoping one of you guys would bring Leanne McAdoo and Margaret Howell with you one time and kind of put a smile on my face. But this past weekend, what I was doing, I was asking, doing interviews with women specifically, and the question was, what matters more, the locker room banter or the leaked emails? And I put that up. It's called the question of the day on my YouTube channel. And a lot of the answers will surprise the hell of a lot of people. I think out of maybe the 30-odd interviews I did, there were only four that thought that the locker room banter mattered, and they were hardcore Clinton bots anyway. So they, you know, the rest of the people I spoke to just saw it for what it was.
But if you listen to anybody out there in mainstream media, they're just freaked out by what Trump said. You know, in fact, Geraldo came out and apologized for jumping on that bashing bandwagon, that bashing Trump bandwagon. He came out with a tweet, said, "I'm sorry, I shouldn't have piled on like everybody else." So Geraldo's got a little bit of sense. But it's just amazing that they're going to try to make these stories that are really molehills. In fact, somebody had a great political cartoon. It was a little molehill, and all the press was around it. It said Trump. And behind him, there are these giant snow-capped peaks that said Hillary scandal, Hillary scandal. They don't care about that. They want Hillary in the White House because that she represents the status quo. Hillary represents everything that I've been against since I started critical thinking back in I guess high school, when I was trying to peek behind the curtain and see what was really going on in our systems out there. And I knew the two-party system was fake, the Republicans and Democrats. They're really the same group of people. And I don't think Trump is really a Republican. And, you know, honestly, I think we deserve somebody like Trump because we had a chance to get somebody in like Ron Paul, and we let the mainstream media steamroll him out of the nomination process. And I don't think Bernie Sanders is good at all, but the Democrats let their party coronate Hillary Clinton instead of having an actual election. So we deserve Trump, whether people like it or not, whether they hate it or not. This is what we're going to get. And I'm sorry he's going to tear down your little system of corruption. I hope he does it. I hope he does it because people need to start going to jail for what they're doing. You can't have a 2008 banking crisis and nobody go to jail because that just breeds more corruption. Just like this Wells Fargo guy, we're just going to let him resign. Oh, we're going to take $41 million from him or not give him those bonuses. But everything else he gets to keep for creating a bunch of fake accounts so he can take your money because you're too busy with your everyday life to needle every little line item out of your checkbook or in your bank statement and go, whoa, 29 cents was taken out, 30 cents was taken out. You're not noticing those. And they don't make that much of an impact. But in the aggregate, they add up. But that's okay. He's a giant banker who helps launder drug money. That's okay. Thanks, Uncle Sam. Keep up the good work, and we'll check out that video of you. Question of the day. Gemma in Illinois, go ahead. What's your question or comment?
Yeah, I wanted to talk to you about, I think it's really great that everything is coming out in batches from WikiLeaks, Julian Assange. One of the things that I think that he's doing incredibly well is making these daily dumps all the way up until the final day, because otherwise then we would have the problem of them getting her out and get somebody else in.
Yeah.
As part of the establishment.
I agree. They could do that. They could force her out with some fake health issue or real health issue even at this point, and then go, oh, we got somebody else to step in. It's somebody that we haven't had to look at or vet at all through our vetting process. And he's clean as a whistle. You know, this is who we need. Yeah, I like that. And it also lets people look through them without being overwhelmed with like 20,000 emails, you know, opposed to like 1,000 at a time. So I agree. Anything else you want to add?
Yeah, you know, I do foresee them trying to keep Trump out by either starting the war with Russia or there's going to be a financial collapse.
Yeah, and then Obama says we got to suspend the election.
Anything to keep out, if that means postponing the election by either the drop in the stock market or we're going to be at war with Russia.
Well, they're running out of time for that, but Russia sure is making preparations. They're doing mass evacuation drills involving 40 million people. They're telling their higher-ups to bring their kids back from overseas who are getting educations overseas. They're saying, bring them back. We don't know what's going on. They might put Hillary in office. The American people might be stupid enough to put Hillary in office, a lady who wants, because she has to cover up for all this stuff that's coming out every day. She has to cover for that. And the only way to cover for that is to go to war. Okay, because they don't care. People don't care that all this is coming out. They only care about this locker room talk. At least that's what the mainstream media wants you to believe. Go ahead.
Right. But I'm a woman, and it doesn't bother me. You know, I raised my children. I was a bartender.
Oh, my God. You probably heard somebody say something.
You hear men talking about stuff like this even in bars. This isn't even in the locker room. You hear it at a bar, you know?
And don't lie, you've probably heard women talking the same way, right?
Absolutely. You know, they come in and they crab about their husbands or their boyfriends and this and that, or they had a good time, or that, you know, he doesn't know how to do this, you know? It's both female and male that do that.
Yeah. Oh, but nobody in the mystery media ever talks like that. None of these pious people that get up there, oh, we don't say anything like that. And I bet if you followed them around with hidden cameras, you'd find all kind of stuff, because you've got James O'Keefe at Project Veritas is coming out with some great stuff with his hidden cameras. We got some Hillary staffers saying, I could grab her on the butt two or three times before I get fired. And then when he's confronted about it, he runs away because these people are scared little ninnies that are afraid of anything. They like to hide in the dark, and they like to do things deceivedly. They like to be deceivers, little great deceivers, which is why I think it's appropriate that we call Hillary Demon. She is the number one deceiver. Here's an article, Secret Terror Deal. This is from The Sun. America plotting to allow 9,000 ISIS fighters to escape terror capital Mosul so they can attack Russian troops, Moscow outrageously claims. And this comes from a source. Let's see. There's a military source in Moscow that told The Star, in preparation for the operations in Mosul, U.S. intelligence agencies and Saudi Arabia agreed that before the assault, all militants will be offered a safe route to leave the city with their families. Remember that convoy that we saw of ISIS? And people are like, why aren't we bombing this convoy? Because they don't want to bomb the convoy. On a supposed agreement brokered by Saudi Arabia, the U.S.-led coalition will only bomb targets agreed with the militants in advance, and basically they're going to go and bomb empty buildings. They might have a kid nearby so they can put a photo op out saying, look, we're bombing children, or Russia's bombing children. 9,000 fighters will be transferred to the eastern regions of Syria for a new offensive operation. We're literally working with the terrorists. Literally. Literally working with people who cut people's heads off, have their children execute people, throw gays off buildings, and commit horrible atrocities. And that's who we're siding with, okay? And Hillary Clinton is part of that group that is siding with these people, okay? And she's got experience. She's got experience. And experience trumps everything. If she's got experience, we got to put her in. Oh, well, we can't have somebody with no experience in there. Please, please. It's just so sad to watch the American people be hoodwinked by this creature, Hillary Clinton. So sad, so sad. Let's go to Bruce in Washington, D.C., The Dirty Tricks. Go ahead, Bruce.
Remember the movie Wag the Tail? As long as the refugee is carrying the calico cat, we're all good. I'm going to answer your question right off the bat. What do I think is the most damning emails out there? Quite frankly, I think the biggest one is all of them, the utter and complete disdain for the American people that these politicians have.
And the supposed democratic process that they like to talk about in public. Oh, we're for democracy, we're for voting. And yet they scheme behind. It's all little schemes going around where, oh, I got the question to the debate. Here it is. Oh, that's the Russians when they get caught doing it. It's insane. Go ahead.
It's not the Russians. There's no way it's the Russians. It's either NSA or people within the DNC. There's hopefully.
Or somebody with a bullet in his back named Seth Rich.
Oh, no, that was a robbery.
Yeah, it was. They didn't take his watch or his wallet or his cell phone. He was totally robbed.
Exactly.
He's robbed of his life, definitely.
I'm right outside of D.C., and there was a gas leak in an apartment blew up with a couple of other DNC computer people that died.
Ooh.
Within a few days of him.
Really?
I'm sure if you look that up, you'll find it out. Yeah. Oh, yeah. It was in downtown Silver Spring.
All a coincidence, folks. These people are good, and they love you. And they got experience, and experience is what counts in this world more than anything, more than a good head on your shoulders. You got to have experience. On screen right now, I'm Leanne McAdoo sent myself and Alex this the other day. This is after Alex called Hillary and Obama demonic, or demons, actually. He called them demons. Let's be fair. Let's be accurate. This is from Psalm 78:45. He sent flies among them, which devoured them. And it's got Hillary and Obama with flies on them and frogs, which destroyed them. And it shows our good old friend Pepe right there. Incidentally created by a Hillary supporter for using their own weapons against them. I love it. Here's an article from Kit Daniels, one of our great writers here at Infowars.com. Leaked email, Hillary supports TPP in private but denounces in public. Remember during the debate she said Abraham Lincoln caused her to have public and private positions and he caused her to delete emails? Well, this comes from one of her speechwriters, Dan Sherwin. Sherwin was writing a speech that assumes she's ultimately going to support both the Trade Promotion Authority and TPP, but gives herself an out to publicly backtrack from corporate trade deals. This draft assumes that she's ultimately going to support both TPA and TPP, Sherwin wrote. These are from WikiLeaks emails, of course. It focuses on what needs to happen to produce a positive result with TPP and cast support for TPA. It's one of those steps. You can keep your doctor, you can keep your plan. Remember that? We showed the clip from Charlie Rose, the speechwriters all together. It was this guy came up with keep your doctor, keep your plan. They all laugh about it because it's so funny how they dupe you people. But they got experience. So don't forget that. A lot of experience there with those people. I hate to harp on that, but that's all I hear from the left. Hillary Clinton got experience. So we got to support her. She's got experience. She's an experienced demon. I agree. Total experience. Let's finish up here. Final callers. John in California. Go ahead.
How's it going?
It's going great. Go ahead with your point. We're running out of time.
Yes. Okay, so Trump could debunk the racist false paradigm that Hillary keeps pushing. I mean, I know there's like a taking a high road, so to speak, about just kind of ignoring it, but there's two points I want to make. Questioning Obama's citizenship is not racist, yet Hillary keeps mentioning that. And Obama's citizenship, Trump also mentioned, I believe, was it Ted Cruz, about whether he was more Canadian than American? And yeah, kind of question his citizenship as well. So there, that just shows you it's not a matter of race. It's a matter of where his loyalties are and where his background's from. And point number two would be border security. Doesn't matter if it's Canadians or Mexicans. I mean, Trump could bring up, I'm sure he could, strategize and figure out what to say exactly. But, it's just making Devel helps just crack the false paradigm that they're trying to push, you know, because it doesn't matter if it's Canadians or Mexicans or where they're coming from, you know, we want Americans.
Yeah, and when they go, it's racist to want to vet Muslims, well, Muslims not a race, it's a religion. Muslims are people who practice the Islamic religion. They could be white Americans. Kareem Abdul-Jabbar is a Muslim. Muhammad Ali was a Muslim. They're not from the Middle East. They're born here in the United States.
When she keeps on using that, you know, and it's pandering to emotions, and it's not logical either, so.
It doesn't matter. She's got experience. What do you know? Let's go to Ed in Hawaii. Let's talk about the Fed buying out the stocks. Ed, what do you mean by that?
So, how you doing? This is an issue that the Donald Trump campaign should seize upon. Basically, Janet Yellen, the last couple of weeks, has been floating the idea that maybe we should think about buying stocks. Currently, the Fed can't do that. It's not lawful, so they need to go to Congress for this. Some of the other lackeys out there, like Lawrence Summers, are hopping on board trying to float this idea, too. What I find interesting about this is they're talking about the Fed Reserve buying stocks and corporate bonds near all-time highs. So clearly, they see something coming, and they need to get it enacted quickly.
Yeah, we got to run. Thanks for bringing that up. Plunge Protection Team, look that up. It's Congress buying stocks to prop up the stock market. They've been doing it for years. Thanks for watching. Infowars.com/show for the replay. And join us tonight for the nightly news starting at 7 p.m. Central.